Hello, dear misfits. This Sunday, we'll embark on thrilling journeys through dense forests, desolate trails and remote campsites where unknown creatures and cryptids lurk in the shadows. From bone-chilling encounters with unknown to hair-raising stories of paranormal. Tonight, we'll delve into the true stories that will keep you awake at night. And as always, thank you for your support. And now,
story time.
This takes place back around 2017 or 2018 when I was a bit younger. My stepfather owned 2 acres of land in the forest in Maryland, while we lived in the small part that separated it from the rest of West Virginia. One day, after a snowfall, my sister and I were clearing a path to a barn he had in the back of the property. As we made our way back, we noticed something strange, bare footprints, measuring about 16 to 18 inches in size. The footprints ended not too far into the forest. We didn't think much of it at the time and went back inside the house. It wasn't until later that month when my sister brought up the possibility that it could have been a Wendigo. We initially played it off as a joke, but looking back, it does make me wonder. Considering it was December, with limited visibility due to the snow, and we were just 2 12-year-olds, the situation becomes more unsettling in retrospect. If I had been the only one to investigate those footprints, I shudder to think what might have happened. What truly unsettles me is the realization that it may have been stalking us every night, waiting for the right moment to try and snatch one of us kids. Now, I can't say with 100% certainty that it was a Wendigo, but everything seems to add up. If anyone out there can help me confirm or shed some light on what we experienced, I would greatly appreciate it. On May 9th of this year, I went on a walk in the patch of woods near my house. In northern Wisconsin with my dog and older sister. My father recently passed away and to attempt to reconnect with my family I took matters into my own hands and invited them all over for a week. Only my sister showed and I wasn't planning on anyone else showing. My sister has always been the stereotypical blue-haired, short, astrology girl and believes in everything you can think about. When we were 12 and 14 she took me to her friend's house to hunt a skinwalker that just turned out to be a stray dog. And since then we haven't done anything in the woods due to her sudden urge to stay inside and smoke pot for months. But that's beside the point. We were walking along a path around dusk and it started to get very cold. We decided that we should set up camp as we are far too away from home to not get back before 6 a.m. and don't feel like hanging out in darkness. After setting up a small fire and tent, she called it a night while I tended to the fire. Roughly 2 hours after she fell asleep I went to relieve myself behind a large dead tree. After coming back to camp I noticed that there was a foul almost rotten smell around the camp. I reached for my bag to get some incense and realized my bag was missing. I panicked for a second until I saw it near the edge of the light made by the fire. Thinking nothing of it I stood up and as I walked toward my bag I froze. My bag was being slowly dragged farther out of the light by a very pale, human-like hand. This hand was in no way human as I came to my senses and noticed the large claws and shiny glass-like skin that seemed to be covered in a clear liquid. "Who's there? Give me back my bag," I said while reaching for my pistol on my belt. Just as I fully unsheathed my pistol the hand suddenly recoiled, however now I could see a face. A large, terrifying face with milky white skin and eyes, with the bluest veins under the eyes. I saw that the thing's tongue was long and was the only thing moving other than the trees and the wind. Its antlers were black. Like they were made of mold. I lost it. I shot the damn thing and with the muzzle flash, I saw a massive, deer-like humanoid that must have been 7 to 8 feet tall. I fell to the ground covering my ears as the creature let out a loud scream sounding like a moose that had been shoved into a meat grinder alive. I came to my senses and saw the thing charge me. I froze as it just to the right of the tent and tipped it over. My sister was already awake at this point as the scream rose her. After what had to have been 2 hours of making the fire go from a small forge into a massive bonfire to illuminate the surrounding woods. Eventually I fell asleep with my Glock 19 in my hands, which were itching to shoot anything that moved. I awoke to my sister shaking me at what must have been 10 a.m. as the sun was already well in the sky. After getting our belongings, we began walking back to the house, checking our surroundings as we went. We didn't want that thing to follow us back to the house and torment us there. When we were able to see the light coming from my yard lights, which I forgot to turn off, I froze. On the top of my shed, there was a gutted what seemed to be a deer without its hind legs. We dropped our stuff and ran to the house, where we called the police. I got fined for wasting their time. I tried to forget this and move on with my life, but on the 19th of this month, I saw that thing in my yard, digging a hole while a dead deer was on its broad, pale, skinny shoulders. It was staring at me. It saw me. It saw me. I blinked and it was gone. I know what I saw. I need help. I have 3 guns in my home, not including my pistol, which I always have on me. Should I try to kill the thing? Please help me. I was 18 years old and went on a fishing trip with my 4 friends, Jack, Zoe, Jocko, and Lex. We chose a fishing spot under a bridge, about 1 mile away from any houses. The day started out fun, with everyone excited to go fishing and relax. We walked to the spot, passing squash fields along the main road, and grabbed a few as we went, along with some corn. We arrived at the fishing spot and spent a few hours fishing, enjoying the peacefulness of the surroundings. As it approached 9:30 p.m., things took a turn. Before I continue, I want to mention that one of my friends is a descendant of the Navajo tribe and believes in druidic beliefs, while I personally identify as an atheist. Suddenly, we started hearing dogs barking in the distance, as if a wild pack of dogs was nearby. However, the chances of that seemed unlikely, so we considered the possibility of coyotes. However, we soon realized that coyotes don't bark like that, they yip instead. The paranoia started to settle in, and we contemplated the idea of walking the 8 miles back and drowning our worries in a bottle of rum at my friend's house. As we made our way back, a quarter of the way there, my Navajo friend abruptly stopped in the middle of the road. His expression changed from concern to sheer fear. I approached him, curious about what had caught his attention, and he grabbed my wrist, pointing my hand out towards the fields. There, I saw it, pair of eyes staring back at me, their size resembling footballs. My friend and I silently agreed to keep this sighting between us. We didn't want to freak everyone else out and risk getting separated, so we picked up the pace, forcing the others to follow along. Halfway back to my friend's house, we passed by a white farmhouse with a cornfield across from it. Suddenly, it felt like a plane buzzed by, and a 40-yard trail of destruction was left in the cornfield. Something had crashed through it. And to add to the chaos, we still heard the dogs following us. As we finally arrived at my friend's house, we pulled out a 12-gauge shotgun and a bottle of rum. We sat on the porch, on high alert. In the distance, we could hear the same dogs that had been following us earlier, whining as if they were upset with us. As the night progressed, I found myself having night terrors, a combination of fear and alcohol-induced dreams. It was certainly an unforgettable experience at my buddy's house, to say the least. I have always loved the solitude and tranquility of the wilderness. Being a park ranger stationed near Yosemite National Park, I had grown accustomed to the sights and sounds of nature. But recently, something had changed. The local wildlife, especially the bears, started displaying bizarre and aggressive behavior. It was as if they were becoming more territorial and predatory. I couldn't ignore the signs any longer. One evening, while on a routine patrol, a pungent odor filled the air. It was a foul stench that lingered and seemed out of place in this pristine wilderness. My curiosity got the better of me, and I decided to follow the source of the smell. I trekked through the dense forest, flashlight in hand, until I reached a small clearing. And there, amidst the towering trees, I saw it. A creature unlike anything I had ever encountered. It stood on two legs, its darkish figure towering over any man I had ever seen. It was a formidable sight, and an overwhelming sense of threat washed over me. As I shone my flashlight on it, I caught a glimpse of its eyes, shining an eerie blue in the beam. Time seemed to stand still as it locked its gaze upon me. I could feel the primal fear coursing through my veins. Suddenly, the creature turned its attention to a bear that had wandered into the clearing. To my shock, it attacked the bear with brute force, overpowering the creature effortlessly. The scene unfolded before my eyes, a surreal clash between two powerful animals.
In a split second, I realized I was witnessing a battle between the creature and the very bear that had been displaying such aggressive behavior.
Instinct took over, and I raised my rifle, aiming carefully at the creature. I squeezed the trigger, and the gunshot echoed through the forest. The creature let out a bone-chilling scream, but instead of falling, it turned and vanished into the depths of the woods, leaving the lifeless bear carcass behind. I stood there, heart pounding, my mind racing to comprehend what had just transpired. Had I truly encountered a creature believed to be nothing more than a fiction? Was it a Bigfoot? The evidence before me made it hard to deny. Days turned into weeks. The once aggressive wildlife seemed to settle down, their behavior returning to normal. I couldn't help but wonder if my encounter with the creature had somehow restored the natural balance. As time went on, no further reports of aggressive wildlife surfaced. The forests returned to their peaceful state, and I began to believe that the creature I had encountered was indeed the cause of the turmoil. It seemed that by confronting and injuring it, I had put an end to him. But I still wonder, was this a Sasquatch? April 2008. At the time, I was an officer with the City of the Moor Police Department. It was around 11, and my partner and I were patrolling near the area around Northwest 19th Street, responding to several calls of screams and an abandoned meat packaging plant. This plant had closed down about 20 years earlier. We never found anything but thought it could have just been teenagers trying to get in trouble. After we investigated all around the plant, not finding anything, we headed back, getting ready to close up the investigation. As we're walking back up, we notice something large moving behind a chain-link fence. Pulling in our flashlights, pointing it toward where we saw movement, that's when we saw it. It jumped off one of the walls on top of the buildings, crouching down, looking at us. It did not look like any animal known here on Earth. It had dark grayish skin with large black eyes, small fangs sticking out of its mouth, and this white hair running down its jawline. With muscular arms almost touching the ground, it looked like a cross between a bat and a human. And it quickly turned, jumping off the building onto another, running across it, and disappearing over a large stack of old wooden planks. My partner looked at me like I was crazy, and I told him what I saw. He said it couldn't be real and that I was pranking him. But when we got back in our cars, ready to leave, we noticed there was also a small hole in the fencing where something had apparently tried to dig into the ground underneath. As we drove out of there, my partner just seemed to get lost somewhere between his thoughts and fear while looking to me for answers. We searched the perimeter and the surrounding area more but found nothing, ultimately continuing on with our shift. After we were off duty, we went to O'Malley's Bar and Grill, about an hour away near Norman, Oklahoma, and we had a few drinks. Not sure if it was the liquor speaking, but as we talked more after a few beers, he admitted that he had seen the same thing too, just before I called him over to help. He tells me that it reminded him of this vampire entity that would visit him as a child every night and terrify him. He claims it would jump from his closet into his bedroom, growl at him, threaten to hurt him and his family. He then describes the same look we saw that night at the plant, the dark gray skin and fangs. But he still denies that this thing was real and that it didn't even exist. When we finished up our beers, We went back to Moore and started our normal routine. This is something that will always stick with me. I was working in the Redwood National Park at the time, and only worked the night shift. I had never experienced a bear encounter in the park, although I heard people had been seeing them a lot lately. My shift was on a Friday night from 10 p.m. to 6 a.m., so I had time to do my thing and catch up on anything. Usually, I carried a radio, a cell phone, and a gun. The radio was a base radio that could reach the visitor center in case of an emergency. The cell phone was specially designed for communication, so I could know who I was talking to. It wasn't exactly a personal cell phone or work cell phone. It was like an enhanced signal phone they give you. The thing about being a ranger at night was you can get very lonely, and the visitor center was closed during the day in these hours, so only other rangers were even working in the park. There was a lot of traveling with nobody to talk to. The radio was key to know what the other ranger was doing and if they were nearby. I took my time that evening, doing my rounds and stopping to enjoy the scenery even at night. It was one of the best perks of the job. Now, the visitor center was located on the west side of the park, and I would have to drive all my way around the west side to start my rounds. To make it to the west side, I would have to travel through the Dipsy Trail, which is a very popular trail for mountain bikers and hikers alike. The trail is open from 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. At night, it was very dark and foggy. I only got a radio call a couple of times during my shift, but never did I see another ranger. As I was driving along the Dipsy Trail, the fog was thick, and I could not see up the road ahead. As I was traveling about 20 miles an hour, I would use the brake lights of the car to see where I was going at some points. As I came around the corner, I saw what I thought was a mountain biker standing next to a tree. Making note of him, I made a comment out loud about how he should not be here, and the trail is closed. As I got closer, I noticed that this person wasn't actually wearing any clothes and was facing the tree. It was maybe about 3 feet away from the fog light of the car, and their back was facing me. I asked out loud several times, and the person did not move. All of my lights were on. Now, I was about 10 feet from this person, and I kept asking if they were okay and if they needed help. I began to get scared. I asked again if they needed help and turned on the siren. I still did not get a response. Something was wrong. I got to about 5 feet away from the tree the person was standing next to, and that's when this person just fell over. They were dead, and their face had been carved away, literally like with a knife. Think of how a pumpkin is. It was as if somebody had burrowed into their skull, and the face was gone. I have no idea how it was possible that they were actually standing up and how they managed to fall over. It reminded me of something that would happen to you in a horror movie, but I bailed out of there. After describing to the other rangers what I saw, they agreed to stay at the station with me, and we'd go back to the trail to check it out. So we all ended up going down there within 10 minutes of the area where I originally saw the person on the trail. But as I got closer to the same spot, now I saw a different figure, a naked woman. I slowed down, and she began looking in my direction. The only issue is, I passed right through her, and her eyes began glowing red right after she passed my vehicle, or should I say walked through my vehicle, and then disappeared entirely. I mean, the other rangers were pretty scared and freaked out. We weren't exactly sure what to do. We just wanted to come out of the park. We wanted to be done. And by the way, there was no account of that body anymore. As a ranger, I should have called the body in and got help, but I was so spooked that I couldn't help but leave. This is when we went to retrieve that body that I'm talking about, the one with the burned out face. There were no signs of it, no signs of blood, attack, a murder, anything. Not even a trail or footmarks. It's as if the body just mysteriously disappeared. And then, the apparition of the naked woman with glowing eyes. I'm not sure what to think about that. Last I heard, and lastly, my colleagues have heard, this trail and park is not haunted. But either way, I'm not sure what to think about it. Maybe it was a demonic encounter, maybe it was something else. I've been in many training sessions and have seen other rangers have paranormal experiences before. I've thought about telling somebody outside my work circle, I've just been very hesitant. People will probably laugh at me, potentially think I'm crazy. But I witnessed something that I did not understand. It changed me forever because it scared me and proved to me that those things sometimes you see in horror movies are true. I've thought a lot about this over the years and have finally decided to open up and talk to somebody. Last night at about 2 a.m., my dog started barking viciously. I have a German Shepherd, she's a guard dog. So I'm no stranger to aggressive barks. But this was the most intense behavior I had ever seen before. She was barking at the door, so my first thought was there's an intruder at the door. Again, I really have never heard her behave like that. I thought about getting a weapon. I was really scared someone might be at the door, but then I remembered that my cat was outside, so maybe it was my cat making a fuss. Even if it was an intruder, my dog would kill someone to protect me. I looked through our peephole but no one was there. So I opened the door. My dog had been barking the whole time. When I opened the door, instead of going out to sniff around like she usually does, she planted herself in front of mine and got even louder. She was guarding me. I have never seen anything like it from her. I looked out to see what it could be, and then I saw it. The first thing I noticed were the eyes. It was like when you shine a light on an animal's eyes, sort of glowing in the nighttime darkness. I then noticed the antlers and thought it must be a deer. But then, I realized its face looked about 9 feet above the ground. Then I noticed its body. I could make the outline and could tell it was fur, but it was standing in a human-like position. Hunched over almost, on its hind legs. I have never been so terrified. As soon as I realized I was looking at something paranormal, I slammed the door and shut all of my windows, locked all the doors, and hid under the sheets like I was a little kid. I am still shaken up. I can't stop thinking about it. I haven't fallen asleep tonight because every time I close my eyes I see it. I'm curious what this creature was. I know the appearance of the Wendigo is debated and seems to be controversial. But I am still terrified by what I saw. If anyone has any information relative to my story, I would love some insight. Thanks to whoever believes me. One of my sons and I like to hike in the backwoods of Oregon and Washington states. Several years ago, we were on a backpacking trip during the middle of the week to several lakes on the shoulder of Mount Hood. Right at dusk, we had a super heavy something walk into our little hidden camp on 2 feet, shaking the ground. It abruptly stopped just outside our little tent. Then there was a big whack sound from where it had walked in on us. We were zipped in the tent because it had begun to rain. We sat still because flight or fight had kicked in for both of us. We were waiting to see what the next move would be. We sat waiting for what might come next. Because of being in the woods backpacking for many years, we learned to have a cool head and evaluate what we might be up against. Then out of the deafening silence, there was an answering rock clap from the opposite side of the tent. We were now aware that we were dealing with two separate things right outside our tent. We sat waiting. Nothing. No noise. No brush or underbrush. No snuffling. Dead silence. We got out of the tent and saw nothing. Since there was only one way out of that camp, and the thing had walked in on the only path out, it was now fully dark, plus a few miles back to where our truck was parked. I made the decision to stick right there for the rest of the night. We would walk out in the morning. I rolled over and went to sleep. I know, strange, but I think the shock of it made me adapt with, and it is what it is at this point. My son laid awake most of the night expecting them to come back. They didn't. No smell. No noise beyond the two signals we heard coming from different directions. The creepiest part of the whole experience was the tranquil retreat. What animal arrives shaking the ground, sends and receives a signal, and then melts away without a sound? I was so glad my son was there with me on that trip. It is helpful to have someone who experienced it all too. Since the night that happened, my son will straight up tell you there is Sasquatch in the deep woods of Oregon. It was a super odd experience for sure. I live on 10 acres in southern Oregon in the woods. I back up to BLM land that goes for miles. I am aware of what is out there beyond our door. I hope to never run into one here on our own ground. No, thank you. This is no joke for me. I'm a park ranger for a state park and the Pennsylvania Game Commission. I was working one day and something I've never seen before stared me down as I was hiking to a remote campsite. I have never seen a deer act like they did. They were terrified unlike anything I've seen in behavior. I have seen coyotes and even bear, but this was something different. I've heard the term dogman before reading this, and after speaking to a fellow Native American friend, he said he had heard of similar creatures. I have to say that the incident, I have been followed a couple of times. I'm only writing this to you because my father said that I will be helped by reaching out to somebody who knows what they're talking about. I have vowed to carry a weapon with me every time I go out, even on personal occasions. If you decide to read this, maybe your audience can offer some advice. For context, I don't actually know if this is a Wendigo-related experience. It's just a possibility out of a thousand and due to my ignorance of the manner I came here looking for answers. For context, this takes place at my grandfather's property in Walla Walla, Washington. It was an ordinary camping trip and I had invited my two best friends from high school. Names don't matter, so I'll just call them Frank and Chris. It was getting late at night and we wanted to kill time before the big campfire of the night. So as fearless teenagers do, we hit the trails. We walk for about 1.5 miles away from camp on a straight trail until arriving in a patch of dead forest. Which was strange because it was the only patch of dead vegetation in a 12-mile radius around the property. So this puts us of edge, it's strange and eerie. Then all of a sudden we all get hit with a sense of suspense and anxiety, and as we look at each other for confirmation of sharing the same experience, we hear a foghorn. Yet again we have no neighbors. And without communicating we all know to just run. We ran and ran, driven by primal fear. The fear that you experience when you know you're the prey. We didn't stop till we were at the fire. I don't know what it was, but whatever it was, I wasn't trying to find out. If anyone has an answer, please tell me. Mainly looking for the significance of the dead forest and the foghorn. I believe my husband and I saw a hellhound. We live in rural northern Idaho and we both hunt. So we know everything about animals, even in pitch darkness. We don't have regular plumbing. We have to turn on an electric well every morning to fill it up. Our tank can last us 3 to 4 days, but we like it filled, just in case. There are other tanks like that scattered in the woods. Just waiting for someone to buy the land and build a home. We were taking a walk and it got dark, so we went back home. However, on our way home we saw something, not human or animal, near one of the wells. It was hunched over like it was eating. We walked carefully closer, about 20 feet from this thing. Trying to figure out what it is. Too large for a stray dog or wolf and too small for a bear. But whatever it was, it looked at us with red eyes. I've never been more scared in my life. My husband is scared of nothing and he was scared too. We took off running. My God, we never ran so fast in our lives. It did chase for a while, then it just disappeared. We got to our house and it was just gone. We knew it was behind us when we left the woods, but we couldn't see it. We locked all the windows and doors that night. We talked to one of the town locals about the thing we saw. He showed us a picture of a hellhound. He told us stories about people meeting the hellhound in the same area, always near a well, roads, crossroads, or places of death. Seeing him once will bring us happiness, seeing him twice will bring us sorrow, and seeing him 3 times will bring us an end. I don't know what we saw, but hellhound is the only explanation. I'm 38 and an Army veteran trying to work as a local carpenter in Maine, the state where I've almost always lived. I've had two encounters with the creature I will soon tell you about, one that occurred when I was a teenager and actually one a couple years ago. The house I am currently living in is my father's since he now has multiple heart conditions and would have to live alone. I and my sister grew up in this house, which is in eastern Maine. Living here as a child always felt a little off, as if something was not right. In a way, it's hard to describe. The house is surrounded by woods on almost all sides and sits on a dead-end road with six or seven houses down the way. We own 70 acres of dense forest that are littered with ATV trails and walking trails. I've been out on these trails over 100 times, probably just clearing them for neighbors who we let use them and just trying to maintain them. But every time I'm out there, I feel like I'm being stalked. In this area, I nor my father have ever seen a bear, wolf, or mountain lion, nothing really above the size of a bobcat. As a teen, I liked dressing up in military gear and going out to play war and games similar. Normally go out with my friends Sid and Marvin, two guys who lived down the road. Sid was an older dude around 18 who smoked and did average tough guy stuff. Marv, who I still am friends with today, we even served together until he was discharged, was more on my level. We were both pretty timid young guys who didn't really associate with most people and just enjoyed being out in the woods and chilling. Anyway, one day we had gone out around 3 p.m. on a chilly winter evening to go play, as we did most days. We all grabbed our gear, which was stuff that Sid's dad, who was a Vietnam vet, had given him and then Sid had shared with us. This included medical kits, an ammo box, grenade pouches, etc. He even gave Sid an old handgun, without the magazine or ammunition, but Sid's dad still didn't allow him to take it out of the house. So after a while of walking down one of the paths, we come to one of our favorite spots, which is sort of like a clearing full of boulders and moss. At the time it was covered in knee-deep snow. Normally my mother would not have let us go out this far, but she wasn't there to say no since she was in New Hampshire for the holidays. We had been out there for quite a while throwing snowballs and pretending they were grenades and blasting at each other with our sticks. It was about 5 p.m. when we were starting to gather our stuff because it was beginning to get dark. As I'm scooping up my stuff, Marv talks in a confused and worrisome tone. "Hey guys, what the hell is that thing?" He draws our attention to a tall, completely black creature standing on two legs, its arms dangling by its sides and dragging through the snow. From our angle at 50 or 60 meters away, we couldn't see its face, but it was walking away from us. I remember a weird tightness in my chest after realizing that I had no idea what we were looking at. Then Sid yelled out, "Hey, hairball." Then the creature stopped. My chest grew even tighter and it felt like my body was frozen after I saw its abrupt stop. It slowly turned towards us. Its face had no facial features, but it looked to be plain flesh. No nose, eyes, or mouth. We were so frightened that none of us could talk. It stared at us for a couple minutes before one of us suggested the bright idea of leaving. We crept away as the sun was now really low, while one of us constantly looked back until we got out of sight. Then we bolted back to my house, where we hid inside, collapsing onto the living room floor. We were silent for a moment before I broke out laughing. The others joined in. After a few seconds, Sid said, "Okay, guys. But WTF did we just see?" We tried rationalizing, but I think we all knew that we had seen something that didn't belong. The guys ended up staying the night at my place that night. We stayed up late drinking hot chocolate and every now and then stepping onto the front porch to see if it may have followed us. After a couple days, the creature mostly disappeared from our minds. We still got together and hung out having adventures in the woods. I never told my parents about this thing that we saw because they probably would have believed me, and I didn't want to go through all the trouble of explaining it to them over and over. Neither did I tell my sister because she wouldn't care and I wouldn't receive any feedback, so it was pointless. We three also never really brought the creature up again. It was like an unspoken agreement. My second encounter transpired in roughly the same area, about a mile or two from there, 3 years ago. I had just been honorably discharged and been home with my father for no more than a month, picking up odd jobs mostly in auto and house repairs, both being skills I learned from my time overseas. It was a summer evening when I decided to head out on the trails and take a look around. After all, I haven't been out there for ages and expected the trails to be overgrown. So I took with me some basic brush clearings equipment such as a hatchet, an old machete, and some other stuff and then set out. Sid had recently moved to Vermont and Marv had been medically discharged a while ago and left with a leg disability making it hard to walk. I would have asked him to join me if not for his disability. I had made it half a mile into the main path moving and cutting up the suspected limbs, branches, and overgrown grass as best as possible, hoping to come back tomorrow with a weed whacker to do some more work. As I got deeper, the feeling of being watched returned, the same feeling I got as a teenager when I was out there. And I began noticing that the dense growth was getting thinner and more limbs were smashed or pushed out of the way. As well, the tall grass and overgrowth were no longer in the way. In fact, the trail became almost cleared and looked like it used to. I was shocked that somebody cared enough to come out here and clear all this. But as I thought on it more, I remembered that the entrance hadn't been groomed, so how did they get in? I began looking closely at the ground, noticing feet or paw prints I had never seen before. I crouched down to gain a better look. The print had three pointy toes, each about 6 inches long, and were spaced about 3 feet apart in sets of two. I didn't recognize these and decided to just follow them a little further to check it out. About a quarter of a mile later, I see this creature. My second encounter, and so far my last time. It was walking from the side of the path at a slow pace, not acknowledging my presence. Not yet, at least. It slowly crossed the path and continued into the woods, and after a minute I walked up to the area where he had entered, and there it was, strolling or creeping into the woods, still not noticing me. I could hear his arms dragging across the forest floor, and his fur coat still looked silky black, yet I wanted to see its face again, but not to the point where I would risk being spotted. So I slowly reached for my phone, only to realize that it was in the front pocket of my backpack, as I didn't want to lose it while working. I pulled the bag from my shoulders and placed it in front of me and began unzipping the pocket. But as I did, the creature stopped as he had done the last time. Oh Lord Jesus, I thought as I froze and my chest tightened. It began to turn. Its fleshy face began staring back at me. I tightened the grip on the hatchet I had in hand, and now that I think about it, that probably wouldn't have done much to the 8-foot behemoth now that I think about it. We both stared motionless for what felt like hours. In reality, I had no idea how long we had been there. I eventually stood up with my legs feeling numb. I backed away until it was out of sight and then took off as fast as I could go. As I was running, I was sure I heard a violent scream from behind me, but I wasn't going to turn to look. Long story short, I haven't been back in those woods for 3 years and don't plan on it either. I know this may sound over-exaggerated or fake, like something from a children's book, but I know what I saw and Marvin knows what he saw. I will never forget this. I was living in a travel trailer for a time on my sister's property, about 3 acres or so, circa the summer of 2019. The house was in the front, on half the property, and I was in the wild lands back field behind the backyard. This was near Redding, California, and the Sacramento River, only several blocks away, basically in the country, and county, outside of town, but quite a few residences up and down the streets around the area on big lots. I don't remember what made me open the door and stick my head out to look around one late evening, but something caused me to do it. Maybe some noise. As I was looking around, I heard what sounded like several very slow footsteps in dry brush, going crack. Snap. Crack. Like someone was walking away slowly, kind of being stealthy. I then realized it was right there, about 15 feet away, maybe on this side of the see-through wire fence, but it could have been right on the other side of the neighbor's property back section. So I was looking, waiting to see some animal wildlife or something, but there was nothing. It was dark, but I had my outside trailer light on and there was some good moonlight. If there was something there, I should have been able to see it. Then I heard someone run off into the backfield. It had to be a very large, if not huge, heavy animal, like a horse. It was bump. 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 I was surprised it didn't shake the ground or trailer. But not a four-legged horse like Clippity Clop, it was an obvious two-legged run, probably with a very long stride. And then it was gone. But I saw nothing like it was invisible. I went back in and locked my door and nothing else happened. I looked around the next day for some footprints but didn't find any. I can only think that it must have been a Bigfoot. Is it possible that it was cloaked or invisible? Okay, so a few years ago, maybe like two or three, I was out walking out in the woods behind my grandmother's house. And I had a really bad feeling like I was being watched and heard something following behind me. Deer season was just about to start, so I thought nothing about it cause I thought it might be a deer. Deer tend to hang out in the woods, so it wasn't much of a worry. I was about to head back through the trees and found a tree that I didn't feel particularly comfortable being near. As I had picked up bad vibes, but I was being stupid and I looked around the tree and it had like really big and strange claw marks in and on the bark of it. There was also some bones from what I'm guessing was a canine. When I had made it out of the woods, I had went inside the house. I don't really remember how I got there, and my grandmother and why I had been bleeding. Note that I always carry a knife on me. So I went into the bathroom to patch it up. That was the end of that interaction. Something of the same sort had happened a few months later when I was visiting my aunt. I had also decided to explore the woods near her place. And I had caught a glimpse of a really tall figure covered in fur. I had taken out my photo to take a picture of it and zoomed in to get a better look at it. And noticed it was covered in leaves and a little bit of blood. It had very large antlers, so I went back to her house and researched about it. Both settings of the woods were both more so marshy. So I decided to just call the Wendigo Marsh. So now I have a Wendigo that lives out behind my grandparents' house. I had also wound up hearing a call and screaming when I was walking. My significant other and I used to manage a fly and fishing resort outpost in very far northwestern Ontario. We did this for a few years in the summers. We would live on an island from late April, early May until mid-October on a lake that had no road, rail access at all. There was also no phone service, no internet, no TV, no electric grid, no indoor plumbing, etc. This shit was as remote as it gets and we'd live it for 7 months out of our year. Now typically the planes that get people in and out of there are little Cessnas, and 50-year-old de Havilland Beavers and Otters, Cubs/Super Cubs and the like. Very old, loud planes that you can hear coming miles away, fly low, 5,000 feet typically, and don't fly past sundown. So this one night me and significant other are outside having before bed smoke and dog is out with us. We're alone this week on the lake as there's no guests on the lake at all. Meaning there's no other humans for about 500 kilometers in any direction from us. It's about 12 a.m., pitch black, and suddenly we see this light come over the trees of our island. But something's off about it. It's not a shooting star or an airplane, that's apparent. It moves weirdly, changes direction suddenly, changes altitude. It's almost scanning for something. It's also completely silent. As we watch it, we both have this feeling of dread and fear. The dog also begins to freak out, barking and hair standing up on end. At this point we run inside and turn every light in our cabin off. We then watch as it continues onward over the lake. As it goes, it stops in intervals and adjusts its altitude. Up, scans forward a few hundred feet. Down, scans forward. Up, scans forward. Down, scans forward. It does this until it's over the next tree line and out of sight. It took us another hour to fall asleep. We've never been believers, so to speak, in extraterrestrial life or unearthly UFOs, but that pretty much converted us on the spot because it was so scary we were shaking afterward. I'm just glad someone was with me because every time I write this it sounds crazy. But it happened. I grew up a hardcore atheist and non-believer in the paranormal. Even the thought of ET life forms with technology capable of light-speed travel seemed far-fetched and improbable. God seemed impossible, and if God did exist according to a scripture, I felt like he was a being without good morals. Around 2017, I became more of an agnostic who shattered his ideals of absolution but still needed evidence for proof. I don't claim to know what could or could not be out there anymore. All I know is that the possibility remains. My father lives off Highway 44 between St. James and Cuba, Missouri. For several years, he has had strange events and sightings at his house and in his area. Going back to 2018, my father, my brother, and I were out at the barn late at night, roughly 10 p.m., doing work on my father's truck. We usually have some type of firearm nearby. As I was smoking a cigarette outside of the barn, I felt really uneasy. Nothing had happened out of the ordinary, but I felt like I was being watched by someone having a scope on my forehead. The neighbors live about a quarter mile down the road on one side of my father's house, and on the other side is an open field. In front of the house is the road with the woods on the other side of the road, and behind the house is about 4 acres of land stretching all in a square that is mostly open with scattered trees, and the forest is the edge of the property. I felt like the threat was coming from the woods behind the house. I told my father and brother, but they felt fine. He told me that if I felt off to shoot several slugs in that direction. So I shot 3 slugs off into the woods. I didn't hear anything more, but the feeling persisted for about another 10 minutes or so. I figured I was psyching myself out and didn't think much of the situation. This happened near late summer or early fall, I believe. Nearly a year later, in mid-July, I went back down there. This time my father instructed me to listen for a sound. It was nearly inaudible. It sounded like a heartbeat coming from the floor of his house. It was only possible to hear it if everything was dead silent and your head was near the floor. Nothing shook, but the sound was so consistent that it persisted at all times of the day and for over several months. I asked him if it was still happening when I left, and he would always tell me that it was, until about October, I believe. It was odd, to say the least, but it never made me feel unsafe. However, in September I went down there for a weekend and had one of the scariest encounters of my life. I felt like a small child who wanted to cry for help. My father, my brother, their dog, and my cousin all went to town. So instead of sleeping on the couch, I went to sleep in my father's room. It was roughly 8 to 10 a.m. when I went to sleep on his king-sized memory foam mattress. I don't know how much time had passed when I fell back to sleep, but I was suddenly woke from my slumber when I felt the bed slightly moved. I figured the dog had jumped up, but I was so tired I didn't even open my eyes. Seconds later, the bed violently raised and slammed up and down for what seemed to be about 10 to 20 seconds. Scared out of my mind, I was paralyzed still. I didn't hear anything other than the bed slamming and the box fan being swept across the floor. As soon as it stopped, I opened my eyes and looked around the small room. There was a closet near the door that was closed and the door that was cracked open, which is not unusual. Afraid to move for nearly 20 minutes, I just sat there. I was hoping that nothing was in the closet. I grabbed the shotgun near the bed and opened up the closet, and it was empty. I then checked the rest of the house. Some open windows with the screen still in and both doors leading outside bolted locked. I proceeded to look online if an earthquake had happened. It didn't make sense because the box fan had been moved nearly 5 feet and was on the floor face down. My family returned after this incident about 2 hours later, and I kept silent because I forced myself to believe it was my imagination. Nearly 2 years later, in 2021, the unexplained phenomena started to happen on almost a weekly basis. My brother moved out, so the only 2 people who noticed it were me when I was down there and my father. He started off the conversation when I arrived there one Friday night with, "I am not on drugs, but I need your eye to tell me if I'm going insane." Since I was more open-minded at this time, I agreed to listen and look at what he wanted to show me. It was nearly 11 p.m. and he instructed me towards his room to shut off his lights. What I saw was a silhouette humanoid figure that would almost leave tracers of itself as it would walk between two different trees in the backyard. From point A to point B, however, at point B, the figure would basically teleport back to point A and repeat the cycle. It also happened in my brother's room, except the figure would seemingly disappear and reappear behind multiple different trees, but still in a pattern. I honestly thought my father's eyes and my eyes were playing tricks on us and I was feeding off his delusions. That's until I saw a light flashing in the woods. It looked yellowish-orange, but it flickered three times right at the house in 3-second intervals that would slowly fade down. He didn't see it at that time, nor did he tell me about it. But when I told him what I had just seen, it was as if I had just confirmed his fears. He said that he had also seen lights in the same area of the woods. We both covered our windows that night with blackout sheets and slept with a firearm next to our bed. I would also hear almost stomping sounds in the attic late at night almost any time I was down there for a 2 to 3 day period. Too scared to check, we just ignored it. I've also seen rusted metal illuminate green, which is highly odd. For the first time, I saw the shadows before I convinced myself they were real. I coughed up multiple ideas as to what was causing them. Maybe it was the moon and the clouds? Nope. It was a new moon and there was a single cloud in the sky. Maybe it was something like a bird, bat, bug flying around the pole lights? The pole lights don't reach the edge of the woods and the silhouette was so dark it was as if some mass had to be right there. These are all my first-hand accounts. I have several other accounts I could add to these, but it could just be more of a coincidence than actual strange occurrences. I don't scare easily. Nor do I usually believe in the supernatural. But I'm now a believer. I am a logger in northern British Columbia, Canada. I am an avid hunter and have spent many a nights hunting alone. That being said, quite a few years ago, I was working on a broken down skidder in the dark after everyone on the logging block was gone, changing a blown hydraulic hose under the cab when I felt like I was being watched. The feeling continued to get worse and worse, so I was on edge and continued to work on replacing the blown hose. Every trip for tools to the service truck and back, I would scan for eyes in the nearby tree line about 25 meters away with my flashlight. Nothing. Continued to work on the pain in the ass hose that you literally have to dive your head and upper body under the cab to reach. And so your legs are stuck up in the air and feeling vulnerable. The feeling of being watched gets more intense, all the hairs on my neck are standing and I hear a two-tone whistle from far away. Almost as if it was wind, it was so far away, but it was flat calm that day. Also, there was about 6 foot of fresh snow on the ground. I pushed myself out from under the skidder and looked around quietly with a flashlight for eyes in the tree line. And down the road. Nothing. I had one side of the hose fitting to remove still, and it was the easier side and higher up, so I wasn't S over T kettle removing it. I put my head back under the cab and quickly began to spin the fitting loose. The feeling of being watched was so bad every hair on my body was standing, and then I hear the same two-tone whistle very loudly in the tree line, directly behind me. I had the hose off at the exact same time, so I whipped myself out from under the cab and turned ready to thrown down with a one wrench in my hand. Yelling, "All right, where the F are you?" Nothing, no one there, no tracks, no eyes, no wind, nothing. The flashlight I had was more of a small flood light for working on repair stuff, so it didn't light up inside the trees. The next day it had snowed another 6 or so. But I went and hiked the tree line with a 12 gauge and 7.3 slugs ready to go. No tracks that I could see, no perches on the trees where snow had been pushed off, if it was a bird. Nothing. A couple of years ago, I used to work at a little coffee shop. I love that place, it was super chill. The kind of place all the real hipsters went to get coffee. Hipsters and old people. I usually worked afternoons and evenings, which weren't as busy as the morning, so oftentimes the manager would leave me to it and I would be running the whole place by myself. One afternoon this lady came in, and to this day I have never seen a more bizarre looking person. I've moved to Austin, Texas since. You know, the place famous for being weird. So trust me, this lady was really bizarre. Her hair was short and up in two knots, Miley Cyrus style. She was wearing a bright pink leather biker jacket, a long skirt, and sunglasses that she never took off. You probably won't believe this next part, but I swear it's true. It sounds like I'm just trying to make it sound weirder, but this is what happened. She was pushing one of those toy strollers for little girls as baby dolls, and in it was her purse. Her purse was open because it was overfilled with bananas. She was pushing around a purse full of bananas in a toy stroller. So she walks up to the counter. "Hey, what can I get for you?" "MMFPHHM, I'm sorry, what did you say?" "HHHHI coffee HHA, alright, a regular coffee, do you want creamer?" She didn't even respond, so I assumed she didn't want any. She paid for her coffee and then went into this hallway in the back that led into a somewhat secluded area from the rest of the seating. At this point I'm thinking she must be really high on something, which would have explained the sunglasses. Anyway, business slows down eventually and I take the opportunity to sweep up the floor a bit. When I come out from behind the counter, she's sitting in the back of that hallway next to the cleaning supplies closet, which she has opened. She has also set up a bunch of those cards you get from like Target or something around her table so that no one can see what she's doing. I walk over to get the broom out of the closet, and as I walk past her I sneak a peek at what she was trying to hide on that table, because who wouldn't? She was burning incense sticks and mumbling to herself. I'm kind of scared to ask her to stop at this point, so I just leave her alone and get the broom and close the closet door. When I come back from sweeping the floor, she has opened the closet door again. I put the broom inside and close it again. So later it's closing time, and she's still here. She's been sitting there burning incense sticks, mumbling, and opening the closet door for almost 4 hours. I yell out to let everyone know that we're closing and they all leave. I go out to pick up people's dishes, and look back into the hallway. She's still sitting there. "Hey, we're closing. I'm gonna have to ask you to leave." "Kay." She doesn't move at all. I'm sure as hell not gonna walk over there and try to force her to leave because she's obviously totally insane, so I just decide that maybe she'll get up in a minute. I finish up most of my closing jobs, which takes about 15 minutes, and she is still there. "Hey. You have to leave. Kay." At this point she is creeping me the F out. It's just me and her alone in this restaurant at night, she's obviously a lunatic, and she won't leave. I walked back into the kitchen and just stood there clutching the biggest knife I could find, but then through the door that goes out to the counter I saw her on her way to leave. She was walking very, very slowly. Suddenly she stopped and stood still. Just standing there doing nothing. She stood like that for 5 whole minutes. Then she proceeded walking as slowly as possible toward the door. It took her another 5 minutes to reach it. Once she did reach it, she noticed some newspapers and advertisements we have on a little counter next to it. She stared at them for a while, and then she took all of them, one at a time, and put them carefully in her stroller. This took her about another 5 minutes. While she was doing this, someone came from outside and opened the door to come in. She froze immediately, not moving a muscle, and stood there blocking the doorway. Eventually the person carefully moved around her and I told them we were closed, so they turned around and left. The lady did not move again until the person was gone. She then finally left, and continued walking at the same incredibly slow pace on the sidewalk. She left a bunch of those advertisements and newspapers on the floor that I had to pick up. Weirdest thing that's ever happened to me. Several years ago I suffered from a manic episode which led to squatting in a vacant home. Long story short, I was eventually picked up by the police and held for about a month until I was allowed to post bail. After I was processed and put into a cell, I became claustrophobic and began to panic. I began pounding on the plexiglass door and shouting into the intercom in my cell. Finally, they asked if I thought I was a harm to myself or others. Now, some people who have dealt with the mental health industry may know that this is the fundamental justification for what's called a 51-50. A mandatory 72-hour hold at a mental hospital. I thought to myself that this could be my way of getting entrance to a mental hospital. So I told the person at the other end of the intercom that yes, I was a danger to myself or others. Unfortunately, that was not the case. Instead, they dragged me out of my cell, twisting my arm and leg, and put me in solitary confinement. They had me stripped of all clothing, not even underwear, and left me with two coarse green woven nylon blankets, one with Velcro to attach to my body, affectionately known as a turtle suit. The walls and floors were dirty and rubberized. In the middle of the floor was a brass-ringed hole to use as a toilet. A camera stared at me from a corner in the ceiling. There was no bed or chair. The lights were on at all hours. Cold air poured in from a loud vent in the ceiling at all times, making it impossible to ever feel comfortably warm. In order to retain heat and feel comfortable against the floor, I'd use one of the blankets as a cushion to lie on, while the other I'd use to cover my body in a fetal position and block out the light. There was no intercom or plexiglass door now. Just a small window to barely see someone walk past my cell through a hallway that gave no allusion to the time of day or night. The only way to generally tell time was by when I'd be fed. They'd drop the food directly in my hands through a small slot in the door 3 times a day. I'd have to finish what was in my hand before they'd give me more or let me drink from a pixie cup of water or carton of milk. They didn't tell me how long I would be there for. They wouldn't answer questions. The isolation and boredom would just cause me to find delusional justifications for why I was there. It must be some sort of test. Right? Sometimes I'd bang on the door yelling for help, to be let out, for water, or I'd curse at the deaf guards that would never answer me. Eventually, I found a sort of rhythm of sleeping or lying awake beneath my blanket between meals. Sometime on the 3rd day, I had a moment where I finally let go. All of my fear and worry, anticipation and expectation to leave just left my mind and body. A warmth filled me. Nothing mattered in that moment and I felt at peace. Then it was gone. It lasted less than a second. Afterwards, all I could do was think of that moment, try to find that place somewhere inside me again while I lay on the ground in my little rubber refrigerator. It was the feeling of a miracle. There's no better way to describe it. To feel happiness in such a place. I was confined for 4 days before they took me out for my first court appearance. As they escorted me through the hall and the exterior doors to the awaiting van, I got to see the blue sky and feel the warm summer air on my face. I immediately cried and thanked the guards. So, my dad and I were hiking back in late November 2005. In a place called the UBC Research Forest north of Pitt Meadows, British Columbia, Canada. About 30 miles east and a bit north of Vancouver. It's on the edge of the mountains, with several logging roads and trails. Anyway, the day was already getting late when we headed out, and the weather was horrible. There was no wind, but there were showers, hail, and slush. It was around 3 degrees Celsius. We were the only ones in the area hiking, and the parking lot was empty both when we arrived and left. After about an hour of hiking randomly up logging roads and trails, we were a good several kilometers into the area when we took a break by a small stream and a small gully. Anyways, we smelled this horrible scent, sort of skunkish, with a human and fish scent mixed in. Neither of us had ever smelled anything like this before. And we've both encountered every large animal there is out here on the coast. Because there was no wind, we knew it was close. We kept going along this hillside. Above us, 50 feet up, was an old overgrown logging slash. Below us, a thickly wooded slope where we could see maybe 100 feet down. We started feeling like we were being followed, and the forest became too silent. Even the local ravens didn't make a sound. We smelled the scent another two times, stronger each time, so we began hiking faster. As we came out of a small gully, we heard a crash. Spinning around, we raced back to the crest and looked back down. Something large and tall, easily taller than my dad who is 6 foot, disappeared into the bush. We just caught a glimpse of dark brown. Since neither of us was armed, we continued on at full pace, knowing there was a logging road ahead. Again, we smelled that weird smell. We heard noises from the old logging meadow above us. Whatever it was moving very silently, yet occasionally breaking a branch or bumping a small tree. I've been followed by bears and cats before, but neither moved like this. It was way too silent to be either. For the record, grizzlies aren't in this area, but I have encountered them before too. After we rounded a bend in the slope, we heard movement again. This time, it was on the lower side of us, or so it seemed. After another few minutes, we heard it again and smelled it. Now, it was moving on the upper side of us, just over a low ridge, maybe 100 feet away. By now, we could see the logging road 100 or 200 feet ahead. Then, this thing let out a cry that sent a shiver down my spine. My dad, whom I have never seen afraid before, except the one time I was near death, another story, went cold. It sounded like a cross between a whoop, a human, and something unknown. It lasted for about 5 seconds. We turned and ran to the road. Running down the road, we passed a junction and continued heading south. I dropped something a few seconds later, about 200 feet past the junction. I stopped, turned, and picked it up. Up amongst the trees, something tall and dark ducked out of sight. I have no clue what it was, but it was tall and fairly slim. It was too dark to really tell what it was, as it was getting close to dark. And so, we ran back to the parking lot. Unfortunately, it snowed the next day, several inches, otherwise we would have gone back and searched for evidence of this occurrence. This, to this day, frustrates both of us. Nevertheless, this is the only time I have ever been scared in the woods. So a few years later, my cousin and I went out to check deer feeders or stands. As we were crossing a field to get to a deer stand that was set up on poles 8-10 foot off the ground, we noticed what we presumed to be a head peering over the top of the wall watching us. We were a good 100 yards off, but it was obvious that something was in the stand. My cousin wanted to go check it out, but I got spooked. I don't know if it was that uneasy feeling of predation or my past encounter with vagrants at our lease. But I talked him out of confronting whatever was up there. We hustled back and told our dads what we had seen. We went back to the stand but didn't see anything watching us this time, so we crossed the field, climbed the pipe ladder to the landing, and found open cans of soup, some dirty clothes, and a mutilated fawn. Whoever had been squatting in our deer stand had killed and was eating a young deer without benefit of cooking, as far as we could tell. There was blood everywhere. Could this be Sasquatch? We never did run into whoever was surviving out there. Fortunate for him, because I was ready to shoot anything that moved after that. That's the last of my experiences. As you can imagine, I didn't enjoy going to deer leases as a kid. My partner and I first heard these stories from a coworker who overheard another officer talking about it. We thought and were convinced they were making the whole thing up. But one night, me and my partner decided to drive around the park to see if we can find anything weird for ourselves. We head down this lone dirt road, tall grass on either side, and suddenly, three deer burst out in the dark to our right. Our headlights caught them moving just as they ran into the trees on the left. So naturally, we could tell they were being chased by something. We turned off the headlights and began moving very slowly, keeping an eye out for anything big. We drove slowly, more and more down the winding road until finally, something came into view in front of us. It looked like a large, hairy man crouched over. And as soon as it came out, you could just see its silhouette against the cold night sky. And since it was so dark, I couldn't see much, but the thing kind of turned around and began moving in our direction, and then moved away. As soon as my partner and I saw it, we got this really weird feeling, like something terrible was about to happen. So we quickly turned our headlights on. By that point, it was already gone. We pulled out of there, left pretty quickly. I don't even want to acknowledge what that could have been. I don't think I'm ready to accept that reality just yet. Let me just say I'm a former U.S. Park Ranger. I have been assigned to various parks all throughout the USA back in 1991. I was assigned to the Isle Royale National Park in Lake Superior. It was my job to patrol almost 100 miles of backcountry and write reports on the conditions of several trails. I would rotate my patrol route every couple of weeks to avoid getting too familiar with the backcountry and kept myself alert. During the first part of late August, I rotated to the west end of the island, to the Greenstone area. The Greenstone is located on the northeastern part of the island. It is like a pile of massive rocks on a point overlooking Lake Greenstone Cove. The area around this point is a well-known spot for the Native Americans, for making tools and other items from the Greenstone and for fishing. The area is also reputed to be very haunted, and some of the stories are quite horrifying. This place is covered in very thick spruce forest, and there are only a couple of trails that even cut through. One of the trails is called the Greenstone Shore Trail. It cuts through the forest and is on the shore of the lake. It is a very isolated area, and the only way in or out of the area is by barge or via the Greenstone Shore Trail. So, I was patrolling the southern point of the trail when I came across a clearing. I stood there and began to hear a very strange noise. The noise sounded like a long, low moan that changed to a very loud sputtering noise. I stood there and listened for a few more moments and decided that I'd better go check it out. I walked into the clearing, scanning the area. I could see a series of old fire pits in the area and something dark lying on the ground about 50 feet away. It was heavy. Whatever this was, which I initially thought was a bear, turned out to be on four legs. So, I took up my binoculars and looked but couldn't really see any details on the animal. I thought it might be a bear, but its shape was beginning to look too big. I stood there for a while as it was still sputtering and moaning, and keep in mind it was kind of tucked away in tall grass. I began to believe that maybe this was a sick or injured bear or animal. So, I ventured around to see if I could get a better view by getting closer to it without directly in its line of sight. When I did, the animal disappeared entirely, but the groaning sound stayed. There's no way something this large could have gotten up and disappeared from my sight that easily. Something was off, I could feel it. After it disappeared, the woods around me went completely silent, and I had this creeping feeling in my stomach that I needed to leave now and that I was in imminent danger. And then, the horrifying thought raced in my brain, what if it was a ploy? What if I was dealing with a large predator, and that was just a way to lure me into the open where I'd be more vulnerable? As these thoughts went through my head, I did not think rationally or clearly. I just got out of the area and did my best to quell my emotions. Now, 2 days after the incident in question, I was in the ranger station filling out reports when the dispatcher began yelling for me to come over the radio. It was a message from the Greenstone Ranger Station. There had been an accident a couple of miles north of the Greenstone Station, and they required my assistance. I got on the boat and headed over there. I met two other boats from the station, and we headed to where the accident occurred. Apparently, four people in the accident who were injured were being chased by some large black animal that they were convinced was Bigfoot. They explained that it had a large snout, huge teeth, and large claws. We took their statements. They were so scared and shaken up they had an accident by getting into their boat, smacking it into each other. Unfortunately, they're all okay with only minor injuries, but the boats, well, that's a different story. I often reflect back and wonder if there's any correlation to the large figure I saw in the tall grass there in that meadow and what they described as seeing from the distance. It was really hard to tell what exactly I was looking at. Even though it resembled a bear, I could tell it was a large animal, but because of how it was laying and how much of its body was truly concealed, there was no way to really know what it was for sure unless I got closer. But the strange groaning and moaning sounds, I'm not sure how to describe it or really write it off or rationalize it. I've heard bears make noise, even deer dying and injured, but this was different. It was so bassy in tone, and the sound was different. I guess it's safe to say that I'm a little creeped out by the whole thing. And after taking these witnesses' statements, I really don't believe them to be making up stories. They were all visibly shaken. The one man, the bigger, older man, was actually shaking really bad, and he almost had tears in his eyes as we were all detailing the same story. Even though this was many years ago now, it sticks with me just like it happened last week. I have to preface this story by saying that what I'm about to recount is a true story. I know, it sounds like something out of a horror movie, but I assure you, every word I'm about to share is as real as the road I drive on. My name is Jack, and I've been a trucker for over a decade. I've seen my fair share of strange things on the open road. So, it was a usual route for me, driving along a desolate highway late at night. The moon was obscured by heavy clouds, casting an eerie glow over the barren landscape. That's when I saw him, standing on the side of the road, thumb outstretched. The hitchhiker seemed ordinary enough at first glance, dressed in worn-out jeans and a tattered jacket. With a sigh, I decided to offer him a ride. Little did I know, that decision would alter the course of my life forever. As the journey progressed, I couldn't shake an unsettling feeling. Strange occurrences began to unfold, and I started to question my decision to pick up this hitchhiker. The air in the cab grew heavy with an otherworldly presence, and I caught glimpses of an unnatural shadow out of the corner of my eye. It was as if the very fabric of reality was shifting around us. Then, without warning, the hitchhiker's face twisted in agony, and he vomited onto the floor of the truck. I immediately pulled over, concern etched across my face. "Are you okay?" I asked, my voice trembling with worry. But as I glanced at him, something unfathomable happened. The hitchhiker's body convulsed and contorted in an inhuman manner. His form began to change before my eyes, morphing into a creature that defied all logic. It was a creature I struggled to find words to describe, but I'll do my best. It was completely white, bald, impossibly thin, and its humanoid shape lacked any discernible facial features. No eyes, no nose, nothing. It loomed over me, crouched in a position that made its true height difficult to determine. But let me tell you, it was towering, at least 9 feet tall. Fear coursed through my veins, overpowering any sense of rationality. In a panic, I threw open the door and sprinted as fast as my trembling legs could carry me. I didn't look back. I didn't dare. Only after what felt like an eternity did I finally slow down and catch my breath. But the creature was nowhere in sight. It hadn't followed me. After gathering my wits, I cautiously made my way back to the truck. My heart sank as I realized it was empty, as if the hitchhiker and the creature had vanished into thin air. Confusion and dread consumed me? To this day, I can't explain what I saw or what became of the hitchhiker or the creature. All I know is that my encounter that night was undeniably real. Growing up, we had a big house on the water set back a couple acres from the road. Most of the land around us was swamp, and when I was 14, my dog brought up part of a human arm. Mom and I were binging Heroes, 2007, and Biscuit got out. We ignored him and I saw the dog rush past the library window with what looked like a big old fish swinging in his jaw. I go on to bed and she hollers for me and comes to my room wide-eyed. "I don't what this is." I go out and it's past the truck and garage in the wide empty space that was there. I shine a light on it and I'm not quite sure what I'm seeing. It's a piece of flesh with three little bones sticking out of one end. My vision does a complete 360 and I curse and look at Mom, who looks terrified. "Ma, You need to call the cops. The police show up, poke it with a stick, then put it in a bag and hold it out the window as they drove to the substation. We later heard reports on CNN about people being cut up and their bodies strewn all along the panhandle. The arm was large and flabby with what looked like a smallpox scar. Our area used to be a hiding place for criminals and bodies. People used to find corpses in their yards after heavy rains. We even had a guy break out of prison transport and run through our yard in the middle of the night. Gotta love Florida. I was around 15 years old and lived, and still living there, in the wonderful Bavarian landscape in a small village. As you might know, we in Bavaria are proud of our tradition and our beer, and so we had something what you would call a party or carnival, only for people of our village. As I was the cool boy in our village, I told the other kids what we can play. We played football, soccer, first, but I got bored and asked my friends if we are going to run around the village and play with our wooden, and a friend of mine even had a soft air, just a weak one, though, guns. So we went into barns and all that stuff and shoot each other. It was great fun. Till one point we were in a barn of an old farmer, but everyone liked him cause he always gave us sweets and told us funny things. He was 83 at that point. One room of the barn was the old slaughter room. When we played in there, in front of us was an old door, but it was locked, but I could have sworn I heard something like a quiet clicking. Generally, it was a really old barn, and my dad told me that it has some underground tunnels and rooms cause of the World War II. The years did pass and the old man died. His wife died almost 10 years ago, and the only son and heir decided to demolish the old barn. What they found in the room with the locked door is still kinda a mystery, and police and news were all at the place, but nobody besides the police and the special teams knew what it was. Later the newspapers got the information that there was an old bomb of the World War II. But fortunately my dad helped the son with the work and saw it first together with the son. He never told me till a few months ago. Until that day, only few people knew the real story. He basically built something like a throne of old World War II souvenirs as a national coat of arms and pictures of Hitler. There were old radios and medal of Nazis. And a lot of letters in which he wrote about operate behind enemy lines, and in which he wrote to his wife and that she has to be quiet. In the middle of the room there was the bomb. And it was indeed still ticking, and one of the best obtained bombs of the World War, and is now in a museum. Diffused. No one knew he was that guy. I was so shocked, and I can only tell you that people in our village still tell rumors about more tunnels and hidden rooms. When I was very young, under 10, my dad would take us to various deer leases for the weekends here in Central Texas. There were always cabins of some sort for us to stay in. This one weekend we went to a lease near Eagle Lake, where there was an old A-frame house, one room affair really, that was at the end of a very windy road. You couldn't see the house until you came right up on it. Well, this one weekend, we came driving out of the Oaks only to notice that there was smoke coming from the chimney, trash all over the yard, etc. There weren't any vehicles though. My dad stopped the truck, got out his rifle, glassed the house for a little while, then decided whoever was there must have cleared out when they heard the truck coming, and seeing as how there was no way we would have missed a vehicle leaving, they must have bugged out on foot. I still have dreams 20 years later about walking into the house to look around. Whoever had been there obviously loved to smoke, as there were ashes and cig butts everywhere. Most of the canned goods we stored up there had been eaten, the cans dumped in the yard, and there was a pot of deer corn, yes, deer corn, boiling on the stove. The thing that has stuck with me over the years was the smell and the open coloring books scattered on the table with crayons dropped in mid-coloring. Out there in the woods was some poor family with at least one kid. I imagine they sat watching us for quite some time before giving up and wandering off. My dad, lacking much sense, decided that we were staying the weekend. Yeah, didn't sleep much. Went camping with my buddies on Canyon Lake, about an hour or two outside San Antonio, Texas. This night was drenched in very bizarre occurrences, and I remember it as one of the worst nights of my life. We were swimming, fishing, drinking beers. Then things got strange. Living in a big city, I rarely got to see stars in myriads, clear and ineffable. I was admiring them with a buddy, until what looked like 10 shooting stars began zooming off in different directions. My heart was racing, and I couldn't believe what we had just saw. Once the awe faded, couple buddies and I went into the wooded area to play drunken hide and seek. We paired up. Not 5 minutes in, we hear our friend yell loudly. We rushed towards his voice. He was hunched over by a tree. He looked at us, and shook his head saying, "Dude, red eyes." I saw red eyes just staring at me, not more than 10 feet away. So we all ran back to camp. It sounded like a cliche prank, but my buddy still to this day, sticks to his story and has trouble being alone at night. Finally, to end the night, we retired to our tents. I had a compartment tent with some friends. I was sitting outside of it with one of them, when our buddy Percy walked up saying something under his breath. He finally started raving about how he needs to go home, and he can't be there any longer, and he started holding his head and he fell to his knees. We tried to console him and he got aggressive, got up and pushed me hard into the tent. I got upset, and he said I didn't understand. I don't know what he was talking about, and neither did he, because he swore up and down that it never happened and that he'd never say things like that or push me. I will not be returning to Canyon Lake. True story, I went on a Bigfoot finding expedition last fall in Oklahoma. I went with a buddy who had been on a few, and who would turn down some camping time. I would have categorized myself as a serious skeptic at the time, especially after last summer's Bigfoot hoax. Everybody on the expedition seemed pretty knowledgeable about the outdoors, open, and very honest. We hiked some at night and some of the more experienced ghost tried wood knocks and calls. Sometimes they would get a very faint answer. Whether it was the real deal or a local half a mile off having fun, I couldn't tell, and I wasn't entirely convinced. We did hear something in the camp near our tent at night, as there were some dead leaf cover. It definitely sounded bigger than a raccoon or a possum. Other members pointed out what they said were tracks in the leaves nearby. Nothing definitive, mind you, but they were kind of foot-shaped and dwarfed my friend's size 17 boots. My buddy and I got to go off with some very cool Gen 3 night vision equipment later in the weekend. He's about 6'7" and 400 pounds, so he's no wallflower. We were about 1,000 meters or so ahead of the rest of the group on an old logging road, and we were watching some bats flying around through the night vision. I suddenly had a very uneasy feeling, like I was being watched, and the hair on my neck immediately stood on end. About 3 seconds later my friend whispers, "Something isn't right. We need to go back to the group." I have to admit my uneasy feeling went to genuine fear pretty quick. We never told anybody else about it, but he admitted that he had the same exact feeling, and was pretty damn scared. All of this could have a rational explanation, pranks or the like, but it was pretty damn creepy. I'm not convinced there is something out there, but shook my skeptical view. My family owns a farm near the Missouri or Iowa border, and I've had a few unsettling experiences where I felt as though I was being followed, triggering the instinctual fight or flight response. We have come across freshly killed deer, and there was recently a young cougar shot on a farm a few miles away, indicating the presence of a fully grown one in the area. One particular experience left me so frightened that I refused to go back there. Behind Fort Leavenworth lies the Missouri River, with miles and miles of swamp and forest that are off limits to people. One night, we were camping a few miles downstream from the fort. Equipped with a high-powered spotlight emitting millions of candle power, we directed its beam towards some points that jutted out into the river. On one of those points, something reflected back at us, two eerie yellow eyes. As soon as the spotlight illuminated the reflections, They swiftly retreated back into the depths of the forest. About an hour later, as we sat by our campfire fishing, a large rock flew over our heads and plunged into the water in front of us. Startled, we hastily left the area and sought refuge in the city park where other campers were gathered. The next morning, we returned to the campsite and discovered the rock that had narrowly missed us. It must have weighed around 25 to 30 pounds, and the location from which it was thrown was uphill from where we were seated, defying any logical explanation. Back when I was like 6, or maybe 7, 30 years ago, I was an unknown predator as a child. Lived in a trailer park, so during the summer it was literally Lord of the Flies from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. One day while me and a friend were snooping around people's yards, we found a rowboat behind a shed. The thing was rotted, falling apart and just not fit for use. But my friend got all excited and said he knew where a lake was we could go sailing at. So we grabbed some skateboards and 2x4s for oars and proceeded to stead the boat. It took 4 hours of dragging it, and another 2 hours of moving it through swamp and forest, but we get to the lake my friend was talking about. To us it was a lake, but really just a pond. We're excited about a job well done and just throw everything into the boat and start rowing out with the 2x4s. We get out to the middle of the pond and we started to realize we're taking on water, lots of water and fast. We start to panic because we can't scoop out water faster than it's leaking in when suddenly we hear a hollow dumb and scratching sound. The boat was sitting on something and we were no longer sinking but still taking on water. We take off our shirts, socks and stuff them into spots we could see water leaking in and finally relax, we can get water out faster than it was coming in. It was then we had a chance to take in the surroundings. It was pretty awesome for a 6-year-old and we're talking about 6-year-old stuff for a few minutes and then I looked down into the water. It was really clear and seemed deep. And then I realized what I could see and what we were stuck on. In the pond we could see hundreds of 50-gallon metal barrels. They were piled up so high in some places the boat had gotten stuck on one of them. It was like looking into an alien world with mountains of barrels everywhere. I think I had just seen Return of the Living Dead, which starts with kids opening a 50-gallon barrel and releasing the undead, I think, so I was freaking out and tell my friend we need to get out fast. So we're panicking and getting water out of the boat and then my friend screams and points down the road. And we both see something worse than undead zombies. The trailer park manager in his truck flying down a dirt road near the pond and coming right for us. Now it might not sound like much, but this was the guy who got you in serious trouble. Trailer park parents generally didn't care what the kids did, but when he shows up to your house to threaten your parents with being kicked out because of what your kid did, you knew you were in for a memorable beating. He pulled up near the pond, and we're trying to row away from him, but we were starting to sink again. He grabbed a rope and threw it out to us and pulled us in. We were terrified. We knew we were in for some serious screaming from him, and beating from our parents. But he didn't scream, didn't threaten, he just stood there staring at us. He asked us what the hell we were doing out there, that we were trespassing, stealing, and what we were doing was wrong. But not screaming. He was calm, kind of scared, like we got him in trouble. We explained what we were doing there, but didn't bring up seeing the barrels. He questioned us forever. We were 6, and then told us he wouldn't tell our parents, which was crazy because he told parents everything he saw, and would bring us home if we agreed to never go out there again, and to not tell our parents, otherwise he would tell them about all the crimes we committed. He dropped us off back in the park and we never heard anything about it again. One thing that did change was he never was mean to the two of us again, but was a bastard to every other kid. He never told our parents about anything we did wrong and was never mean or threatening to myself or my friend again. I and my wife used to travel to New Hampshire from Massachusetts to buy cigarettes once a month. Anyway, on this day we decided to drive from the cigarette store to Brattleboro, Vermont along this long winding route that went through some woodsy areas. We were about halfway along this route when we crested the top of a hill and I had to take a leak. It just so happened there was a pull-off area just under some high-tension power lines and what looked like a dirt access road for service trucks for the lines. I didn't pull into the road but did park in the pull-off. I walked about 40 feet or so into the woods to not be seen by anyone passing on the main road and started to do my business. Then, all of a sudden, I heard something falling from or tearing through the tree branches. It startled the heck out of me. My first thought was a maybe a rotted limb had broke loose and was falling from one of the tall trees. Then I heard the thump. I was horrified to see a boulder about the size of a basketball slam into the ground about 10 feet from me. My first thought was maybe I was trespassing and someone was trying to scare me off. I yelled, "Hey, knock it off with the rocks." No sooner did I get that out of my mouth when I heard the branches sound again from the same direction, and this time I could see the branches waving and bending as another boulder was heading my way. I zipped up and beat feet back to my car as I had my 2-year-old son and wife in the car with the top down. I quickly got in and tore out of there as my first thought was for the safety of them as well as myself. My wife was asking what was all that noise and who were you yelling at. All I could reply was that some jerk was throwing rocks at me. That's when it all really hit me, these weren't your normal sized rocks that anybody could just throw. Not to mention that they were tearing through the tops of 50 to 80 foot maple and oak trees from a long way off. When this reality hit me, I felt dizzy and dazed as to the danger I was truly in and WHO or what could do that. I got to tell you, I spent years pondering and replaying that in my head, never coming up with a logical reason. I even went back to the place years later to see if maybe there was a hill or ledge where those boulders could have fallen. But nope. Nothing nor any property or dwellings anywhere near, just those power lines with the rutted road beneath them. It wasn't until I was watching TV in 2015 while I was laid up with shingles and the continuous YouTube that I saw some guys in Canada had a similar thing happen while fishing on a lake. The only difference is they saw what was hurling the boulders, an 11 to 12 foot hairy creature. So I do believe I had a Bigfoot experience. I got a very unbelievable story to tell you. I don't know if you're familiar with the Skinwalker Ranch over here in Utah. I have a close relative that is pretty much the UFO guy in that area. He's been telling me these stories ever since I was a little kid. I've been out to that ranch several times and I was out there in the spring, 2013, and nothing happened. We went around the ranch areas and nothing happened. We went home and on a Saturday night, something did happen, which I later found out through my UFO relative. There were some Ute Native kids driving in a tall truck about 8 feet high and they went up to the gate of this UFO ranch. They said that they saw an orb of light appearing in the window off or above the gate, and I guess they turned on their lights or they turned on their engine because they got scared. Then it had an even brighter light and it went over their truck and these kids. Well, something hit their truck. These kids got scared, so they went down the road to the main road and they got out, which is, I'm guessing, about 3/4 of a mile. They got out to look at the damage done to this truck, and for some reason, the driver decided to be the passenger and then the passenger was the driver. Apparently, there are some girls with them in this truck. Well, once they got back in the truck, this is where it gets very unbelievable. A creature grabbed this kid, who was the driver and now the passenger, and pulled him out of the truck. It threw him around like a rag doll, bit him on the butt several times, and clawed him. Long story short, somehow this kid got back in the truck and one of the kids took a picture of this creature, no image provided. They got scared. They were able to get back in their truck, drove down the road, and talked to the Ute Indian police because it's a Ute reservation over there. The Ute Indian police say there's nothing we can do about it because they're very well aware of the Skinwalker Ranch. So the next day, which would be Sunday, they contacted my UFO relative and he went down there to investigate. Meanwhile, there was a shaman's wife and the shaman was there blessing the kids that were involved in this. My UFO relative said that he saw the picture on his cell phone of this creature. He also saw the damage done to the truck. There was also a scratch into the truck, die, and he also saw the damage done to this kid and the bite marks. Now that was very unbelievable for me to hear. The crazy thing about it is, a few months ago, I work at a hospital, and one of my patients was actually the shaman's wife. She was the one that was also there at that time when my relative was there to investigate. She told me exactly what my relative said, but in greater detail. The creature that she described, and also my relative said, had to be a tall creature because he would hold this kid out of this window. That's the 8-foot tall truck, and this creature had horns. It had red hair. It had a human-like face, but the mouth was distorted and it came out kind of like a wolf. It had claws and it had wings. So my question is to you, and I asked my UFO relative, is this the skinwalker? And he goes, no, this is something totally different. And I asked also the shaman's wife, and she agreed that it was something totally different. I've had a few paranormal experiences throughout my life, but the strangest and most unbelievable was what I know I used to see as a teenager. A gnome. It wouldn't have even been as tall as my knee, probably halfway up my shin. It had a red hat and a white beard. He was a typical garden gnome, only he wasn't a statue. I saw him at least a dozen times through our living room window, frolicking about in the garden and along the windowsill outside. I'd sometimes even see his silhouette through the blinds if they were closed on a sunny day. My parents, obviously, always brushed it off as silly crap kids say when I told them what I saw. Oh, don't be silly or aw, did you? They never paid it any attention, and why would they? I even remember my father saying something to mom like, we don't even have a garden gnome, and she responded that it was just an active imagination. I lived there until I was about 18 or 19, and I don't even think anyone in our street owned garden gnomes at all. It never even once looked at me, like he didn't know I was watching or perhaps didn't care. The last time I saw him was about 20 years ago. I'd never spoken about it to anyone but my mother and sister during my adult life, else I'd probably be admitted to a mental health ward. When I asked mom, she still remembers me talking about him when I was little. Most people reading will probably think what a load, but I promise this is true. Was he real? Or possibly a fabricated memory of some kind? Why would my mind make me remember fake stuff? Has anyone else ever seen one? This happened in the western suburbs of Sydney, Australia. I spent a lot of time in Africa both on business and for pleasure. One time there were about 8 of us that went camping in a national park in Zambia. I was with a friend and the other 6 I did not know. There were 2 other couples and 2 single females. We spent the afternoon getting to know each other and pitching our tents, had our dinner and retired to our tents for sleep. Around 3 a.m. in the morning I hear the 2 females freaking out. There was screaming like I have never heard before. To be honest, I was shitting myself. I thought some animal was attacking them. My adrenaline was pumping like crazy. I always remember hearing that when people are screaming they are okay, it's generally the quiet ones that you should worry about. So I got my torch and found the courage to open up my tent. At this point the screaming was continuing and I could now hear scratching noises. The other members of the group were remaining very quiet. I am sure they were just dry mouthed and did not want to bring attention to their tents. I slowly opened the tent and shone the torch in the direction of the girl's tent, and I saw 2 hyenas walking around the tent. I know that generally hyenas are generally timid creatures around humans, but they have been known to attack and kill people in rare circumstances. By this time the guide was out of his tent and simply shouted at the hyenas and they ran off. One of the golden rules of camping in the domain of wild animals is not to keep any food around. Always keep food in sealed containers and make sure everything is clean and washed properly. It turned out that one of the girls has some biltong, dried meat, in the tent, and the hyenas has smelt it and were trying to get at it. Couple years back I volunteered for a sea turtle conservation group on St. Catherine's Island off the coast of Georgia. It's a small island and at any time there can be fewer than a dozen people on it, and it's not developed beyond a few generators, refurbished slave cabins, a mess hall and a few conservation buildings. When walking around at night, it's basically pitch black because of the forest canopy, so most people have a flashlight or headlamp with them. Anyways, I was walking back to my slave cabin from the mess hall alone and my headlamp wasn't working. I couldn't see a damn thing, so I'm basically stumbling over stones and stumps. As I'm walking, there was a scream. Only way I can describe it is as a deep, guttural grunt type scream. Made me stop dead in my tracks. After a few moments, I keep walking, still messing with my headlamp. The damn thing finally turns on and I'm face to face with a deer. I'm in the middle of a bunch of deer just standing around, and this one is just staring at me right in the eyes. I was within a foot of it. Scared the living shit out of me. I walked around it and ran back to my cabin. I am a reasonably social person. 4 years ago, I was living in Pittsburgh and decided to bike to DC, about 350 kilometers. There is a trail that goes and is fairly fast from civilization, especially in the West Virginia, Maryland stretch. It's a known route a lot of people do often. However, normally you'd go in a group and do it in 4 to 6 days. I went alone and was done in 3. This meant leaving before sunrise and finishing after sunset every day, pedaling to no end and having no one to talk to. By the end of day 2, I started hearing voices. Not random amorphous voices you normally have in your head. Voices belonging to specific people in my life. They were saying things consistent with those people's personalities, and we had long conversations about a whole host of things. Most interestingly, I was aware that this was all happening in my head the entire time, but had no way to turn it off. It all went away once I had a good night's sleep and a real meal, but it was a very interesting experience. I imagine this is what schizophrenia feels like, minus the awareness that the voices are not real. It was a wild night, one that I'll never forget. The date was September 1st, 2020. I live in Naperville, Illinois. I was headed back home on a public bus, I believe it was a Pace, and I was pretty much alone. Just me and the bus driver and one or two other people. That in and of itself was strange, but I'm not sure that was related. Anyways, I board the bus and the bus driver is stopping off at plenty of locations. We arrive at one where there's little to no light around it, no street lamps, no houses or buildings, no nothing. The only thing illuminating the scene was the dim light inside the bus and the headlights. The bus driver opened the doors and nobody budges, but as the bus driver began to close the doors, we heard these really heavy footsteps come out of nowhere. Then I heard the most god-awful sound I have ever heard. It wasn't quite screaming, it wasn't singing, but it sounded angry. The bus driver began to open the doors again for the thing to the board, but as soon as it came into eyesight, nobody wanted that. That thing. To board this bus. The driver shut the doors as quickly as he could, and this creature became infuriated. It was wearing women's clothing, an orange shirt and an orange hat with some shorts. It had been hot here. But that thing was not like any woman I've ever seen. I don't even know how to describe it. It could have the power to shapeshift if that's a thing. This thing, it was a she, or at least wanted to appear so, began pounding on the bus doors, howling its angry, screaming song. It went on for a long time. The bus driver was clearly in shock and confused and downright scared, as he should be. Hell, I was scared too. I don't think any of us knew what to do. And at the same time, we weren't sure if this thing would follow us. If we did let the creature in, would it harm us? Kill us even? Would it chase after us if we didn't? If we called the police, and it left, would they even believe us? It wasn't any kind of cryptid like Bigfoot or the Chupacabra. Was it an extraterrestrial life form? It is an experience I will not forget ever in my life. The first thing I did when I arrived home was look up anything similar, to no avail. So, after these 3 years, I decided to report it. I know that you have been involved with the Chicago Mothman sightings investigation, but is it possible that this thing is related? It happened again late one night in September 2018. I live in Northeast Pennsylvania. I've been an experiencer for most of my life. They made no attempt to show up quietly either. There was an electrical storm, and I've seen craft hanging around those. So when one of these storms, with no rain, was hanging out directly over the house for a while, I knew they were coming. They took out the lights first. And I tried not to be scared. I'm tired of being scared, so I asked how to make the fear go away. I tried to go about my evening routine. Then there was some sort of hissing at the front door. Was I imagining it? No, that is definitely for me. So I got mad. You have to honor free will. You can't take me against my will, I repeated many times. Now though, I think this was my opportunity to cooperate had I let them in. I wish I had the courage to do this so I could learn what they're doing. The hissing stopped when I refused to open the door. Storm got angrier. So I went to bed. I kept repeating variations of the free will thing for a while, not happy that they clearly had other plans. Then I called my sister to attempt to wait them out. Talked with her for a while. Then tried to go to sleep, since by now the power was back. I told them I need my alarm for work. Thought they might move on. Still wide awake, but I can't sleep. My cat starts weirdly slinking off the bed like he's stalking something in the corner of the room, but very slowly. So I sit up to see what he's watching. The blue light from one of their freaking wands blinks off. I could see it under the door when I sat up. The cat calmed down and returned to his spot. Apparently, they don't just control us in our sleep. I called my sister again. Now I'm really upset. She tells me to come over. It's too late, even if I wanted to. They are determined. So I resign myself to my fate and go to sleep. I have to get up in 4 hours by now. They must be trying to take my soul again like they did the only other time I remember seeing the stick with the blue diode at the end, because I had a brief out-of-body experience. The last time I saw it, one of the few times I remember anything at all, they were trying to teach us how to leave our bodies. But by teach I mean they rip you out forcefully to get you used to the feeling. Empathy is not a thing the gray being have, I guess. But I don't think it's them. I think what runs the show are the reptilians. I sat up in bed from sudden pain, it shocked me awake. But then the pain from my arm falling asleep in my body pulled at my soul, and my actual body sat up to absorb the soul. I watched myself sit up into myself. Kind of cool. Then they knocked me out, I guess, because I was out immediately afterward. I had personal enlightenment recently, where I felt the fire of the chakra alignment send this new energy up my spine. It's a more intense ability to connect to the universe I haven't had before. I can literally feel it now when I tap in to talk to the universe. It's like tingles up my vertebrae. I have a very strong feeling their sudden intensity was because of this. They've never been so obvious before. Clearly, I needed to be studied immediately. But they don't want the body. They only want the soul. Them and that damn stick. I think I might have a soul contract with them I need to figure out how to get out of. I had a hypnotic regression done a few weeks after that incident. It was very disappointing because my questions were not answered. The encounters have been less severe since then. I'm just hoping that it eventually stops. When I was in my early teens, I visited my dad in Pennsylvania. He had just gotten remarried and had another child, my baby sister. Anyway, I fell asleep at my new grandmother's house downstairs. This is a three-story house with a basement and an attic, five floors. And I had no clue where anyone else was. I woke up downstairs on the couch around midnight in utter terror and could not explain why. I felt as if something in the shadows was watching me and I needed to get away. I ran upstairs and got into bed with my dad, who never woke up. Moments pass and I feel something on my legs. I wanted to look but couldn't look. I must have been paralyzed. It seems like hours passed as I slowly somehow began to work my head to the side and saw one of them peeking over my father with its hands over his mouth. I received a telepathic message of some kind that he shouldn't be smoking and that something bad might happen to him because of it. I don't know if it was a threat, and these are childhood memories, so it's very difficult to specifically put into words. If I had to describe these little creatures, they would be like Salacious Crumb from Star Wars, very goblin-like, very skinny with big ears. There was a bigger one standing at the foot of the bed. I was fighting this paralysis the entire time, and I think it's this ability to fight their paralysis that made them interested in me in the first place. Anyway, I see the big one who seems to have an oval-shaped flat and purple-like head with a dark cape. The body never moves, but the head can swivel 360 degrees like an owl or something. At first, the being was extremely interested in the books on the shelf. Paperbacks and hardbacks. Novels. For whatever reason, it was checking all these books out. There were two identical ones, one bigger than the other though, marching in place in the corner of the room. They were glowing white and looked to be very furry or luminous. Big bushy circular bodies with spindly skinny appendages. A big one and a little one both glowing, both marching in place in the corner of the room, not looking at anyone. This seems to go on forever. At some point, they migrated to the next room where my little sister was sleeping in her crib. At that point, I felt strength. I felt anger. That's what it was. You are not going to touch my sister. And I shut off the paralysis and jumped out of bed. As soon as I did that, the two beings marching in the corner went down to the floor and the light began to change in the room. I saw them march downward through the floor and then I ran into the next room. The rest looked at me and floated quickly toward the stairwell as the light from 8 a.m. in the morning brightly lit the entire house and they went down the staircase and turned into indistinguishable vapor in the morning light. Believe me when I say I was in pitch black for an endless timeless state and then it was immediately 8 hours afterward. That was my first experience. It gets weirder so after that, I went back home to Mississippi with my mom and began having nightly experiences for the next 8 or 9 years. I'm not going to go into those details because they were terrifying and I don't want to think about them. But eventually, I felt that the danger must be coming from the window in my room. I didn't like my room anymore. And I had witnessed too many weird things around my window late at night. So I rearranged my room and blocked up the window by putting my bed right beside it. You'd think that this wouldn't be the right move, but it made me feel safe for whatever reason. The night I did this is the one I will never ever forget for as long as I live and I get chills just thinking about it. I woke to the back door being kicked open and immediately I knew that our house was being robbed. I tried to stay as still as possible in my bed with my eyes just barely cracks of lashes to be able to see what was going on but still pretend that I was sleeping. I hear a commotion in the hallway outside my room. Thinking about it now, it could not have been adult people. These were either a whole bunch of small creatures or not actually physical disturbances. It was a commotion. A torrent of motion through the hallway. And then my bedroom door slowly crept open. Standing in the doorway was a bright ball of light. When I was a child, I figured it must be a flashlight, but my memory does not agree with that. As an adult, it doesn't make sense to me. It was simply a ball of light. And it moved on. I heard commotion throughout the house. I heard a struggle. I heard fighting and my family being in pain. I was too afraid to move. I wasn't exactly paralyzed. I felt like they were maybe testing me. Finally, I hear my mother calling my name and pain dragging herself across the carpet. I will never forget this for the rest of my life. I was too afraid to move to help my mother. But strangely, the sound of her pulling herself across the carpet never advanced. It stayed right outside my door. I felt like they wanted to lure me somehow and I didn't understand intellectually, but instinctively I knew I should stay put. This dragging noise went on for a timeless state yet again. Then, like a switch of up light bulb, it was morning and I hadn't even closed my eyes. So I ran to the phone and dialed 911, but hung up immediately. My brother was asleep in his room. My mom was asleep in her room. I woke her up and asked her what happened last night. She said your brother had an asthma attack and we left you here at home alone at midnight. So I got all into energy work and Kundalini yoga and became a Reiki master and attempted to understand what this spiritual energy was that I have that allows me to fight their paralysis when I become angry and impassioned at them. This spiritual force that fights them was my main goal in life at that point. I needed them to stop and it worked. For a long time. I have many more stories about this intermediate period where I kept them at bay from terrorizing me, but began to have truly interesting and enlightening experiences with the UFO phenomenon. It led me to believe that there may be some good ones and some bad ones. Either that, or they don't all come from outer space. So maybe goblins coming from an extra-dimensional realm beneath us. No idea really. I'm just relating what happened. The story goes on. Even up until the present day. Would you believe me if I said I have trouble keeping ordinary jobs? I have a difficult time relating to normal people. I'm always far out and crazy. And nobody understands. I wonder why? Is it possible that I may be one of them? This incident happened to my grandparents. I'm from Puerto Rico and my grandparents are fully Puerto Rican. Anyway, to the story. It was the mid-1960s. My grandma was about 25 and my grandpa was about 20. My grandpa returned from the war in Vietnam and my grandparents moved to a small town on the outskirts of Maricao, Puerto Rico, another small town but slightly bigger. It was a warm night. I'm not sure what time it was because they don't remember, but they know it was about midnight. They saw a light on top of a mountain. Let me explain Maricao. It is a very mountainous region. People that are not familiar with Puerto Rico don't know that Puerto Rico is a really mountainous region. The light was on top of a mountain, but my grandpa thought it was a fisherman because fishermen usually fish at night in the region. The thing is, there was no source of water near the mountain, so my grandfather found that weird. Anyway, he kept staring at the light. The light was starting to approach them. It arrived in their front yard about 10 yards in front of them, and it stayed there as if the thing was watching them. My grandpa is literally scared of nothing. He's encountered ghosts and the paranormal before and never even had a drop of fear in all of the experiences. He saw a figure in the craft. The craft was about the size of a medium-sized SUV, except it was a shape of an oval. My brave grandpa got a flashlight and seriously walked toward the craft. He turned on the flashlight, the craft left quickly. It looked like disappeared, except when he looked at the sky, he could see the craft exiting the Earth's atmosphere. After that, he never experienced a UFO sighting, even though he had a lot of paranormal experiences afterward. He believed that the other experiences were somehow related to his encounter with the UFO. So yesterday I was in the Colosseum in Italy. I was on a flyby visit to Rome as I wanted a few days to have a break. I didn't book a ticket in advance and managed to get an entrance ticket without a tour. So I was walking around by myself with the usual number of tourists running around, taking photos and chatting away. Anyway, I was pretty excited as I've always wanted to see Rome. I was walking up the stairs to the first floor of the Colosseum when I suddenly felt strange. Like I was flooded with fear. It was like I was sensing the fear of something else. I knew that the thing I sensed was not only afraid but knew when it was about to die. It could smell blood and death as it was being let out. The feeling of fear was also tinged with confusion. As I walked up the stairs, the feeling got stronger. I then felt that it was trying to say that its bones were still here. I knew it wasn't human. Now, I don't usually feel things like this. I've never felt like I am psychic or anything like that. I'm quite pragmatic, and though I've had weird things happen, it's never been a feeling like this exactly. I also know that the first floor was for spectators, not for anything or anyone who was about to die. So my feeling did not make any logical sense. I was willing to dismiss what I was feeling, and though maybe I'd had too much sun. I got to the top of the stairs and walked around. The first exhibition I see were the bones of animals that had been discovered after having been killed in the Colosseum. The feeling got stronger and then just disappeared. I didn't feel anything like that for the rest of my visit. Now I'm home and I can't help but reflect back on those moments. Was it a frightened animal who had died a painful and confusing death, stuck there for millennia and randomly choosing to reach out? Or did I just lose my mind for a moment? I honestly can't shake the feeling and it's left me unsettled. Has anyone else had a similar experience there or elsewhere? On another note, always book month in advance for a tour to the Colosseum. You can get much better tours than what I got by just turning up. It was a sunny summer afternoon when my friends and I decided to go fishing on the Saskatchewan River in the beautiful province of Saskatchewan, Canada. Little did we know that our outing would turn into an unforgettable encounter with the Sasquatch. As we set up our fishing gear and cast our lines into the calm waters, laughter and excitement filled the air. We joked and shared stories, unaware of the extraordinary event that was about to unfold. It started innocently enough, with strange rustling noises coming from the dense forest surrounding us. At first, we dismissed it as the wind playing tricks on our ears or perhaps an animal lurking nearby. But as the rustling persisted and grew louder, we couldn't help but feel a sense of unease creeping into our hearts. Suddenly, a towering figure emerged from the trees, capturing our attention like nothing else before. At first glance, we thought it must be some kind of prank. Maybe one of our friends was playing a joke on us, dressed up in a costume to scare us. But as we looked closer, our jaws dropped in disbelief. Before us stood an actual Sasquatch, or Bigfoot, as some call it. Its massive frame towered over us, covered in shaggy brown hair. Its muscular arms hung down by its sides, and its eyes seemed to hold a mysterious wisdom. We were dumbfounded, frozen in both awe and fear. It was as if time stood still, and all we could do was stare at this creature of legend. The Sasquatch seemed curious about us as well. It observed us with a mixture of caution and intrigue. We could see its intelligent eyes scanning our group, assessing whether we posed a threat. It seemed almost human-like, yet undeniably otherworldly. As the initial shock wore off, a wave of excitement and fascination swept over us. We fumbled for our cameras, eager to capture this extraordinary moment on film. But as we fumbled with our devices, the Sasquatch, sensing our intentions, vanished back into the depths of the forest, leaving us in a state of disbelief. We spent the rest of the day recounting the encounter over and over, dissecting every detail, and questioning our own sanity. Had we truly come face to face with a legendary creature? Our fishing trip had transformed into a surreal adventure, forever etched in our memories. News of our encounter spread like wildfire, sparking both skepticism and intrigue among the locals. Some dismissed our story as a wild fabrication, while others were filled with curiosity and wonder. Regardless of the skepticism, our group knew the truth. We had experienced something truly extraordinary on that fateful day along the Saskatchewan River. From that moment on, our lives were forever changed. We became avid researchers of the unexplained, delving into the mysteries of the Sasquatch phenomenon. Our encounter with the legendary creature became the catalyst for a lifelong pursuit of truth and exploration. To this day, we hold on to that memory, cherishing the shared bond we have as witnesses to the enigmatic presence of the Sasquatch. Our fishing trip turned into an extraordinary adventure, connecting us with a world beyond our own, where legends come to life. And though skeptics may scoff, we know in our hearts that we were privileged to have a glimpse into the elusive world of the Sasquatch on that fateful day along the Saskatchewan River. Honestly, I don't know how much I believe in cryptids, but my mother once told me a story. It involves my great-great-grandmother and her neighbor, essentially her boyfriend. Later in life after her husband passed away. The story was shared with my mother by this neighbor when he was still young. According to the neighbor, he and his friends were playing a game of hide and seek one day. It was a typical day in the 1910s. As he found a hiding spot, nestled away from his seeking friends, something strange caught his eye. From the corner of his hiding spot, he saw a sight that would forever be etched into his memory. A long, white creature emerged from a sewer drain, moving on all fours with an uncanny grace. Its form was unlike anything he had ever seen before. It seemed to possess a certain alien quality. Curiosity overwhelmed him as he watched the creature intently. It crawled with an eerie precision, almost as if it knew it was being observed. Without warning, it disappeared into another nearby sewer drain, leaving the young boy in a state of both awe and confusion. As my mother relayed this story to me, I couldn't help but be intrigued. The image of this mysterious creature crawling through the sewers lingered in my mind. What do you all think? And before you start, Mother would never lie to me. A camp instructor I once had was mountain biking or camping somewhere in Canada with a mate of hers. It was up in the mountains in a really remote place, so she's biking around and they decide to set up camp in a clearing up on the trail. They see the clearing is perfectly round and the trees surround it so they can't see out. They're chilling making noodles near the tent as the sun's setting and they see, around 10 to 15, people have surrounded them. The people are wearing dark robes and, apparently, something similar to HP Death Eater masks. The masked people start stepping in unison and get closer and closer to them. They start freaking the F out and screaming at them to stop, then get on their bikes and kick some of the people away and ride down the mountain as fast as they can. They come across a cabin and start banging on the door and a dude, a hunter of some sort, comes out. They explain the situation and he radios his buddies to go check it out with him act. Turns out that place is a high action cult area and there has been missing persons and people taken by cults. Oh, and when the hunter got there all the tent and stuff was taken. I live in Western North Carolina in a very secluded area. We have bears, we have seen coyote, deer, even cougar on a tree cam, bobcats. What I am saying is I am familiar with the animals in the woods around me and I know that what I saw was not an animal. One night about midnight or so our animals were acting very strange. The chickens were awake and squawking, the cats were up on the roof of the buildings or under them and growling, the dogs were whimpering and whining backing into the corners. So my son and I went to check just what was scaring them. He walked the property checking the pens and looking for anything. So we get to the back of the property where we have a utility path cut through to the mountain ridge. This path is about 6 foot wide and cuts along the top edge of a gully. Well, about 30 foot from where we are standing is something. Darkish figure that is standing on two legs way taller than any man. It turned its head and looked at us in a way that made me feel threatened. The eyes shine blue in the flashlight beam. It looked at us and then turned and walked down into the deep gully. I have no idea what it was, but my son and I both saw it and it was not an animal or a man. I swear to you, what I'm about to share is a true story. I work at NASA, and for obvious reasons, I need to remain anonymous. Let's just call me Randy, after the legendary guitarist Randy Rhoads. I've always been drawn to the mysteries of the universe, and little did I know that one fateful day, my life would take a mind-boggling turn. It was during a routine space mission, monitoring the vastness of space from the control room, when something extraordinary happened. As I gazed at the screens displaying data from distant planets, my eyes widened in disbelief. There, amidst the black void, appeared an object that defied explanation. At first, I thought it was a computer glitch. But curiosity got the better of me, and I couldn't resist investigating further. As I zoomed in on the object using the cameras, my heart skipped a beat. It was no trick of the light or fabrication. Right before my eyes, the object revealed itself to be a highly advanced extraterrestrial spacecraft. Words fail me as I attempt to describe its appearance. The craft had a sleek, metallic exterior, with a silvery sheen that seemed to shimmer in the distant starlight. Its shape was unlike anything I had ever seen, a combination of smooth curves and sharp angles that defied conventional aerodynamics. Mysterious symbols adorned its surface, symbols that were alien to any known language. Fighting the urge to panic, I knew I had to document this unprecedented encounter. I grabbed my camera and snapped as many photographs of the UFO as I could. Every detail was essential. I watched in awe as the craft maneuvered effortlessly through the cosmos, defying our understanding of propulsion systems. There were no visible rockets, no conventional means of propulsion. It simply glided through space, defying the laws of physics. Just as I thought the encounter couldn't get any more bewildering, the unimaginable happened. In an instant, the craft vanished before my eyes, as if it had never been there. I was left dumbfounded, my mind racing to comprehend the enormity of what I had witnessed. Filled with a mix of awe, disbelief, and a hint of fear, I immediately contacted my supervisor. Trembling, I recounted the entire encounter, from the initial sighting to the abrupt disappearance of the UFO. The gravity of the situation was palpable as my supervisor arrived, his expression a mixture of concern and secrecy. As he examined the photographs I had taken, he urged me to keep this encounter strictly confidential. He emphasized the potential impact on the public, the fear and chaos it could incite. I was instructed not to share my experience with anyone, not even my closest colleagues. My discovery was to remain hidden from the world. Still reeling from the surreal events of the day, I returned home, my mind swirling with questions and uncertainties. I couldn't shake the feeling that the truth needed to be revealed, that humanity deserved to know. Fueled by a sense of responsibility, I decided to take matters into my own hands. And that's why I'm here, sharing my account with you, Horror Den. Anonymity provides a shield of protection, allowing me to reveal the truth without risking my career or the stability of society. This story must be told, and it's up to those who hear it to decide what to make of it. Remember, this is not fiction. This is my first-hand experience, and it has forever changed my perception of the cosmos. I'm a park ranger here in the Northern Cascades. I frequently respond to emergencies, search and rescue, and also do some law enforcement work myself. This summer, I was working on a trail crew about 20 miles from the husband campground. I dropped back a few hundred yards from the crew to relieve myself, and I noticed a large, sickly sweet odor in the air. It kind of smelled like bear feces, but it was different. As I stood there, I heard crunching twigs from down the trail, and that's when I saw this large dark figure walking upright in my direction. I turned and began to hide behind a tree. As I turned back to look, it was maybe only about 10 feet away. It was black, a bit shorter than I, with no visible neck that I could see. It stopped at the tree I was hiding behind, sniffing the air with its nose pointing up. I could not see any visible eyes. I was rooted to the spot in fear and could not physically move a muscle. And then, it turned around and walked away casually in the same manner it had arrived. I stood there for a few more minutes to see if it would circle back around, and then ran back to my crew. I refused to tell anybody what I'd seen. I hope nobody has to experience such a thing. Greetings, I hate to be a bother, but I have a story to tell. Please do not think my mind is going from the many stories you all hear, and bear with me that this is very hard for me to do, although I believe it needs to be said. Last summer, on July 4, 2017, around 10 p.m. at night, I was driving home from my family cookout. Late at night, I was also off duty. It was about 11 p.m. near the swamps by this point, and I live in Gulfport, Mississippi. What I saw, a figure up ahead on the side of the road, caught my attention. As I got closer, what I thought was a normal man, I soon realized that this was not the case. It stood over 8 feet tall, long legs and arms that reached down below its knees. It had dark scales all over its body, but most notable were its hands, which hosted four fingers each with long claws. The most bizarre thing, though, was its head, which appeared more like an iguana or a dinosaur than a human being. Upon seeing this strange creature, I slammed on my brakes in total shock, not knowing what to make of what I was looking at. It didn't take long, though, before I became aware of my presence as it quickly turned its head, looking directly at me with glowing yellow eyes and some sort of light that seemed to emit from within its skull. And then, it began walking towards my vehicle as if trying to scare me or intimidate me to leave. In a panic, I reached for my gun, which was on the seat next to me, quickly aiming it at the creature's head, not knowing if shooting this thing would kill it or not, but wanting to stop whatever this thing was in hopes it would just leave. As soon as I took aim, this thing let out a nasty growl and came rushing at me with great speed. Seeing this thing moving so quickly, I was overwhelmed with fear, slamming my foot on the gas as fast as I could. The last thing I remember is seeing in my rearview mirror if it was going to give chase, but instead, it just turned around and kept going back into the marsh. I don't know how long it took me to get home that night, but all I knew is that at the time, whatever the creature was, Satan himself couldn't have been any more evil looking. I went home immediately after and told my family what had happened, but of course, they didn't believe a word of it. There were no tracks or anything else to prove the encounter ever happened. However, about a week went by, and I could swear I smelled that same deathly stench coming from the swamps when I drove by again, but no sign of it. So, I just dismissed it all, thinking it was a trick being played by my mind. I've watched a couple of your encounters on your YouTube, hoping to find any proof of anything that might explain what happened to me that night. But after a while, you just learn and let it go. Until this past spring, one of our own deputies told me he had an encounter with one of these creatures in the swamps himself back in 2015. He said that he had seen something covered in mud running through the brush, trying to hide, only then to turn its head at him before turning around and disappearing into thin air. He also said that shortly after seeing whatever this thing was, his cruiser's engine gave out, along with metal bending, that he had to have the thing towed back into town. I don't know if there's any truth to what we saw, but I'm not taking my chances, and I will pray every night before going to sleep for the Lord and Savior to keep me safe from whatever we might have encountered out there in the swamps. Last year, in June 2022, 17 cats went missing from my ranch. I have a private rescue providing heated cat hotels, food, a lake, 7 stall stables, and medical care for 35 to 45 cats. We have bears and mountain lions, and deer too, all wild. This is on the Kentucky or Tennessee state line. One morning, last August, my German Shepherd and I started our morning walk when a vomit-inducing stench crossed trail winds. It was a horrid smell of urine, dead rotting flesh, and feces. My dog started growling as we approached the end of our 29-foot camper in the driveway. Then he went nuts, charging against his leash, barking, jumping 4 to 5 feet in the air, in front of us. Then he pinned his shoulder to my knee and pulled me to the left, then back to center, then back to right, back to center, the whole time staring up at a 45-degree angle. The hair on my neck raised up and I pulled my .45 caliber pistol for a possible shot from the hip. I practice hip shooting a lot. I noticed with the barrel pointed out it was level with the ground, but when I pointed it to where the dog's nose was pointed and it was 8 to 9 feet above the ground. I have trained most of my life to remain calm during a crisis. Noting how high the muzzle was pointed, the stench, my dog's behavior, and my location, I thought I may be looking at a cloaked Bigfoot, invisible to humans but not to dogs. I began talking to it in a calm, slow baritone command voice. I told it I was tired of it killing my cats. My cats were my kids, feeding them, housing them, giving them meds, and protecting them was my job. If it didn't stop using them as snacks, I would kill him. I don't want to kill you, but I will, I said. Stop killing my cats. There are a lot more humans than there are of your type. How would you like to be hunted down? As I finished, my dog sat but continued to stare 9 feet off of the ground. Soon, the stench was gone and my dog relaxed. Over the next couple of months, I began to see rabbits, skunks, deer, and coyotes, and my cat stopped disappearing. I'm a retired airline pilot and former Special Forces soldier, and worked for 10 years as a police officer. I live near Fort Campbell, Kentucky. I'm a believer. I'm very late to this post, but I thought I'd share anyways. I am in the Navy and, at the time of this anecdote, I was part of a security detachment for a freighter off the coast of Iran. It was a few hours into my watch, probably around 1 on a gun mount, when a small fishing vessel near the horizon starts beaming our ship with a high-powered laser pointer. This is actually a pretty common occurrence in the area, but I reported to my superior to make sure they were aware. About 2 or 3 minutes later, I look back over to where the vessel was to check on it and it's gone. It was the middle of the night in the ocean, but my naked eye should have picked up the boat with relative ease. I put on my night vision goggles and scan the same area forward of the ship. Nothing. Literally, nothing. No vessel, no stars, no horizon, just nothing. I felt like I was tired, perhaps my night watch was getting to my head. I took off the goggles and did some jumping jacks and push-ups for a few minutes and took another look. That's when I saw it, an impending wall of gray, no start, no beginning, just gray. Fog. Heavy, thick fog, thicker than any fog I've ever seen. Within moments every metal surface was coated in mist, I could not see more than 20 or so feet in any direction. It was eerie, the civilians piloting the ship didn't use any horns or anything, we just sailed through the dense cloud. I couldn't even see the water, my only perception of speed was the thick mist moving past me. Luckily, nothing happened, but when you are standing an armed watch on a big freighter near Iran, in waters that have had reports of pirates, and your most important sense is taken away from you. I couldn't help but imagine what could happen as we moved through that dense fog for, what seemed like, 20 minutes. A friend of mine and I have been experiencing strange things as of late, the past week or so. My first potential encounter with this thing happened 7 years ago, but in the past week, my friend and I have experienced some terrifying phenomena, climaxing at what he saw earlier today. The story is pretty long, so I'll hurry this up. It starts around 7 years ago, I was camping with my family in northern Michigan. The campsite was near a large lake, so we went swimming often. I looked across the lake and saw a large white figure moving on the other side. It was around 8 feet tall, had no fur, walked upright, and had no visible facial features. The moment I saw it, it ran into the woods. This was my first encounter. The story picks up around a week ago when my friend was in his house home alone with his dog. It was around 11 p.m., he was in his bedroom when he heard his mother's voice speaking to his recently deceased dog. His other living dog appeared to hear the voice as well. His mother was at work, so it could not have been her, and the dog to whom the voice was referring had died around 4 weeks beforehand. After this comes my second experience. I was reading in my room when my mother's voice called for me to come to the living room. The sound was accompanied by what sounded like someone walking in my living room. The only people home at the time were me and my brothers, who were asleep in their room, so I panicked and locked my door. Nothing happened for the rest of the night. The next day, my mother came into my room, asking me what I wanted. I was confused as I did not call her name. After I explained this, she appeared shocked, nearly certain that my voice had come from my bedroom. And finally, earlier today, my friend was walking his dog, when he heard a rustling noise in a nearby sewer. Thinking that it was a raccoon, he walked over and looked into the drain. What was staring back up at him was a creature that he described as completely white, bald, thin, humanoid, and had no facial features, no eyes, anything. It looked around 9 feet tall, but it was hard to tell due to its crouched position. After a few seconds, the creature dashed away into the sewer at an incredibly high speed. My friend then immediately called me and explained the situation, which led us to write this post. We would like to know if we are in any danger from this creature, and if so, how to protect ourselves from it, as well as what this creature may be. Good morning. As I sit reading this article, it amazes me that no one caught one of these things yet. I understand that if something with a 25 to 30 feet wingspan flies past you, you're not going to grab your camera as a first instinct. My son and I saw this thing in the summer of 2010 in Mertztown, Pennsylvania. We were parked on the side of the road in a heavily wooded area when this thing casually glided up the road. It looked big enough to carry a full-grown man away with no effort. When the winged thing flew over the hood of my car, we instantly ducked down. This thing had a round human-sized head with no beak and huge bat-like wings. Now I would never tell this story if it wasn't for my 16-year-old son sitting in the back seat who also witnessed it on that summer day. I'm a pretty capable guy, not too many things can shake me, but this thing scared me. Here is what I saw. The body was 5 to 6 feet in length accessible. The wingspan was 25 to 30 feet easy. No feathers, bat-like skin, jet black, and a 4 to 5 feet skinny, rat or dragon, like tail that stuck straight out. This thing didn't fly like a bird, it glided about 10 feet off the ground at a plodding speed. After 50 to 75 feet of gliding, it took one huge flap of the wings, never changing elevation, and glided up the road till it disappeared into the woods. I'm convinced this thing lives underground, probably near some sort of hot spring because it has no feathers. Well, that's my story. Feel free to reply with any questions. That 45-second event will forever be etched into memory. I say we find it and catch it. I would love to see it again up close. So this is something that I'm still experiencing to this day. Like, literally as I'm typing this. I'm just gonna start at the beginning. I live in a rural area surrounded by woods and that's about it. A few years after moving here, me and my father started hearing things in the woods at night. It started off just sounding like an animal until we both heard what sounded like a little girl saying hello. When looking around with my father, no one was found. This continued for years, but never to this extent. A few months ago I was walking home from taking up the trash. It was around 9 p.m. and dark. As I walked, I could hear something following me in the woods next to me. I assumed it was just a squirrel or something until I heard laughing directly in my ear. Loud. I was unable to run due to a mild leg injury at the time, so I just called my mom as I walked home. Nothing else happened that night. After that, our dogs would start barking like crazy every night at around that same time. Then, starting a few months ago, this thing started trying to imitate our dogs. We always let the dogs in at 7 p.m, and around 9 p.m. the barking would start. The barking in question though is very obvious not natural. It is almost human-like and follows a strict pattern. Bark, 1 second, bark bark, 3 seconds, and repeats for about 30 minutes before stopping. Once stopping, there will be taps and scratching on my window for a few minutes before everything stops completely and returns to normal. No one else in my house really cares as much as I do, and I know I'm probably overreacting. There is probably a decent explanation to this, but for now, I'm going to assume it's some sort of skinwalker or crawler. I'm an ecologist, used to work as an environmental monitor for some pretty remote mining operations here in Australia. Long backcountry driving, taking water samples upstream and downstream of the mine. That sort of thing. Most field days you're looking at about a 12-14 hour day and you're unlikely to see another human being the entire time. During the shorter daylight months, I'd often be starting and finishing work in the dark. About a month into the job, I noticed when driving down the roads through the scrub after sunset, there were all these little glimmering reflections on the road and in the grass. As if there were lots of little specks of broken glass reflecting back my vehicle spotlights. After seeing this every evening for a couple of months, I decided to find out what it was, got out of the truck, walked over to one and realized it was the reflecting eyes of a spider, coming out begin their night's hunt. I must have passed millions of them before finding out what they were. I don't know too much about the full extent of the sighting, but back in 2001 my dad worked for a farming company and had to help in building a new grain silo. He said that while he was working, he kept getting the feeling he and the others were being watched. He happened to glance up at a tree line close by while grabbing a panel and said he saw something thin and pale staring at him. It didn't make any noise, and most definitely wasn't an albino deer or a goat. He kept eye contact with it for about 30 seconds before it backed away and disappeared. He didn't talk about it, but when he and the others went to lunch, one of them brought up that alien-looking F and my dad said he'd been so bewildered by it that he didn't know what to call it. In my local area, we've had several paranormal events, aliens which I have a hard time believing, our own Bigfoot called Murfreesboro Mud Monster, the Enfield Horror, Whistlers, Native Spirits, Thunderbirds, that sort of stuff. My dad only recently told me about this, and I've been searching for what it was called. I definitely think he saw a crawler, and possibly a young one since it seemed like it was insanely curious. But I dunno, what does everyone here think? My daughter, who was 11 years old at the time, was visiting my parents for the weekend during the summer. They own 55 acres in the woods in northern Michigan. Most of the property near the home is cleared, roughly about 7 acres. The rest has sporadic trees here and there until you get to the back 8 acres. Before it gets dark, they like to sit out on their screened-in porch and watch the deer come out to eat, which was done this night. The plan was to wait till the sun went down so she could practice riding her CT200 Coleman bike. It is a small bike that only went 20 miles per hour, and it had a decent headlight on it, so it was good for the cleared trails on the property. While her and my dad were sitting on the porch, just before sunset, my daughter was watching the open field for deer. But instead, she seen something that looked like a white dog moving very slowly. It was roughly 200 yards away from them, and she said, "Grandpa, what is that?" He looked and he looked very confused. My dad is a man who has grown up in the woods, he knows every animal and everything possible about where they live. He told her it looked like it could have been a white coyote, it had a similar size, but it didn't look like any coyote he had seen. The body of the creature was very thin, almost bone skinny and didn't have a tail. He went and quickly grabbed the binoculars from inside the house, he looked and he said it looks really deformed, like a deformed pit bull. It's facing away, so I can't really see its face. It left view and they continued sitting there waiting for dark. When the sun set, my dad made sure to tell her not to go fast, because riding at night was something new. He knew that she knew the lay of the land well, but was worried since it was her first time doing laps night riding. When he was done with his safety brief, she took off. As she was riding her way around the property, she had a weird feeling of being watched. But she pushed those thoughts to the side because she assumed it was nerves on top of it being dark in the woods. As she rounded the corner to the straightaway with her light shining down the path, the light from her bike reflected back two eyes. She slowed her bike down, thinking it was a coyote or a deer. As she came slowly closer, she realized it was white. She was frozen in a panic when she realized that this was the creature she and my dad seen in the field. Only this time she was just feet away. The creature was facing her and she was able to clearly see its head this time. It was crouching with its long skinny arms hanging down against its side. It had the head of a human dying of malnutrition. It had a huge chest and its rib cage was very prominent. What she thought was white fur was skin. It had white skin with gray undertones. It looked like death. Its eyes were half the size of its head and completely reflected the light from her bike. She was still riding towards it, unable to react due to being frozen in fear. The creature's mouth then became clear. It was really big and unnatural. As she got closer, she started to realize that this creature was very tall, tall like my dad, who is 6'3". She said the long skinny arms that hung down to its sides had human-like hands. She started to feel sick and woozy. Then, she snapped out of it, turned the bike around and headed back to the house as fast as the bike went. One night, a few years ago, my aunt and I were driving down a familiar road we had traveled countless times before. It was a typical evening, nothing out of the ordinary, until something caught my attention. Out of the corner of my eye, I glimpsed a fleeting figure darting across the road and disappearing into the woods. I couldn't shake off the strangeness of what I had just witnessed. The creature I saw was unlike anything I had encountered before. It was smaller in size, hunched over, with a grayish complexion and sparse hair. The way it moved reminded me of a chimpanzee or some kind of primate. Instantly, I knew it wasn't a raccoon or any other familiar animal that I was accustomed to seeing in the area. Living on the East Coast, I was accustomed to the local wildlife and had seen my fair share of creatures in the region. However, this sighting was completely out of the ordinary. The image of that peculiar creature lingered in my mind, and I couldn't help but wonder what it could have been. I immediately shared my observation with my aunt, expressing my bewilderment at the sight we had just witnessed. She, too, was taken aback by the strangeness of the encounter. It was clear that this was no ordinary animal crossing our path that night. In the years that followed, I kept an eye out during my travels, hoping to catch another glimpse of that mysterious creature. However, it seemed that the sighting was a singular event, a fleeting encounter with an enigmatic being. Despite my curiosity, I never came across anything similar again. To this day, the memory of that night remains etched in my mind. I often find myself pondering the nature of the creature I saw and the mystery surrounding its existence. Was it a rare and elusive species that had managed to remain hidden from human eyes? Or perhaps it was a creature from folklore, venturing into our world for a brief moment. While I may never know the true identity of the creature I encountered that night, the experience has left me with a sense of wonder and an appreciation for the unknown. It serves as a reminder that there are still mysteries waiting to be unraveled, even in the familiar landscapes we think we know so well. So, as I continue my journeys and explore the world around me, I keep my senses sharp, ready to embrace the unexpected and embrace the possibility of encountering something extraordinary. Who knows what other secrets the night may hold, just beyond the reach of our ordinary perceptions. In the summer of 2009, my girlfriend and I were on our yearly camping trip with her mom, dad, and her brother and his wife. That year the six of us had traveled north from where we lived near Albany, New York to a campground in the Adirondack Mountains. It was a small campground, but they did have full cabins there as well as sites for both RVs and tents. My girlfriend's parents rented one of the cabins for a week and we planned to set up a tent for ourselves just outside of the cabin. We had left after work on a Friday. We ate dinner when we got there and hung out by the fire pit. The six of us talked about all sorts of things. It was a great first night. We were all tired though, so we headed to bed at about 9:30. We'd been up since 5 a.m. that morning having worked a full day, so we were all pretty tired. The moon was full so there was plenty of light around but not enough to see details beyond 20 feet or so. I pitched our tent relatively close to the cabin. My girlfriend's brother and his wife pitched their tent on the far side of the cabin about 50 feet away. About an hour later, after falling asleep, I was awoken by my girlfriend, who had said she heard something outside our tent but couldn't see anything out the mesh window. She thought it sounded like heavy footsteps walking through leaves and twigs as it moved around our site. We were near the center of the campground where there weren't too many trees. I listened a bit but could barely lift my head since I was so tired. I didn't hear anything, so I told her not to worry and that whatever it was would probably move on soon. It was probably just some forest animal checking out our scent. I instantly went back to sleep, but I woke up again when she nudged me awake a few minutes later, saying that whatever it was had moved closer. She said that she could hear breathing outside the tent and felt like something was looking at her through the mesh window. I reluctantly gave in and woke myself up to check out what might be going on. I told her not to move as I slowly unzipped the flap of our tent. As soon as I did, my girlfriend let out a scream because something jumped from the area right outside our tent and jumped into the trees right across from us. We both saw it at the same time before it darted behind the trees. It then stopped and looked back at us. It was about 7 feet tall, muscular, and had a large head with long hair. The creature didn't seem aggressive but instead seemed curious as it stood there staring at us for what felt like a long time. It had yellow eyes that almost glowed in the dark, and I feel I saw a mouth with sharp teeth. After standing there for a few seconds, it turned and slowly walked away into the woods on the other side of the campground. I unzipped the tent flap all the way and stepped outside very cautiously. I looked in the direction that it had gone, but I couldn't see anything in the dark. I stood there for a bit listening before I went back inside the tent and zipped it up. I was now doubting if we had really seen anything at all, but at the same time, we both just laid there in our sleeping bags for several minutes, not saying anything and barely breathing. We were both in shock at what had just happened. We stayed awake for probably the next 2 hours, and we did both hear distant screaming noises a few times that night, but somehow we both finally fell asleep, although I have to admit I had dreams of being chased and running for my life through the forest. The next day, when we all got up and were making breakfast, I told my girlfriend's brother about what happened. I asked him if he had heard or seen anything at all. But he said he hadn't, so it was looking as if only my girlfriend and I had experienced it. But later that day, after a morning hike, we were sitting in the cabin with her mom and dad when one of the campground managers came by with his dog. The dog looked like a German Shepherd mix. The dog was acting very strangely, as if he had spotted or smelled something unusual in the area and was trying to pull his owner towards it. The manager passed the time a bit talking to us and checking in on us before finally asking if we had seen anything like a bear around recently, saying that his dog seemed to be very interested in our area specifically. He was wondering what could possibly be up when we told him no. He seemed relieved but said that he had received a report from other campers that they had seen a large black bear in the area and that it was smart enough to have learned how to open up their locked food storage containers. I don't know if what we saw was a bear or not, but I do know that bears don't usually stand 7 feet tall or walk on their back legs. I'm pretty sure bears are nocturnal, so there's that. What exactly did we see that night? I'm not sure, but it was definitely something very strange and out of the ordinary. My girlfriend and I are confident that it wasn't just a black bear but something much more, and the fact that other campers had reported seeing something similar in the area lends credibility to our story. After I graduated high school, I went on a 10-day-long backpacking trip with some friends of mine through the terrain of Utah and Arizona. One leg of this journey involved trekking for a couple days through the Paria Canyon or Buckskin Gulch system of slot canyons in southern Utah. The hike initially began without a hitch. It was really, really hot, so getting deep into the canyons was a welcome respite from the heat. This particular season had been extremely dry. Normally, when you're trekking through this system of canyons, you can expect to go through sections that have water. Some of these flooded section of canyons are so prevalent that they are named features, like the cesspool. When we went through, it was bone dry. We didn't even need to get our water shoes out. Now, what you need to know about slot canyons is that they are extremely prone to flash flooding, and thus can be extremely dangerous. Storms well over 50 miles away can send water cascading down these narrow, 2 foot wide in places, canyons and giant walls over 100 feet high. Not a lot of wiggle room for torrents of water, or for a hiker trying to feebly run away from the wall of death behind them. A morbid reminder is the presence of these giant logs wedged between the canyon walls, dozens of feet above you, indicating the height to which flood levels rise. This also means you can't set up camp just anywhere. It is vital you find a sandbar elevated above the floor of the canyon in the sparse sections where the canyon widens out, just in case you're unlucky and a transient flood just so happens to pass through. You can tell it to be safe by the presence of vegetation growing on the tops, unable to be washed away by floods. But as I said, it had been really dry up to that point, so we weren't really worried about that. When we stopped for lunch about halfway through the trek, I looked up and noticed little cute cumulus clouds floating by. The deserts are known for their random thunderstorms. As we continued walking, the sky began becoming less and less blue percentage-wise, instead filling up with more and more gray. As it became overcast, there was a true sense of despair rising up within me. Total helplessness. In this sort of situation you have no control, there is nowhere to go, nowhere to run. I felt this vividly sad sense of acceptance, like as if a judge had sentenced me to death to be carried out that day, with no chance to tie up any loose ends in my life. This whole time my friends were oblivious to the dangers, and were joking, which made me feel worse due to the extreme juxtaposition of the situation, but I didn't really want to ruin their fun. And then it started drizzling. You know when people jokingly say they were so scared they shit their pants? As soon as I felt the drops on my cheeks, my bowels were seriously coming loose. That feeling of first date nervousness times 1000. I actually had to stop walking to regain composure and control of the muscles responsible for that function. At this point I pointed it out to my friends and the march down the canyon became a lot more serious. The drizzle continued for 20 minutes and this whole time I was listening intently to either ends of the canyon for the inevitable roar signaling our doom, fervently looking for little, green islands of safety. Thankfully, the drizzle abated, and the task at hand was to find a place to rest our poor bodies. But finally, after a physically exhausting trek of 22 miles in the sand, made mentally exhausting by failed pack winching up rock falls, resulting in major loss of water, and most of all the surreal drizzle scare, we finally reached a section of land that could accommodate all of us, about 10-ish. Too happy to put the trials of the day behind us, we wasted no time in getting dinner prepared and getting ready to turn in for the night. Little did we know. This was the start of the most bone-chilling experience I have ever had. To this day, just the memory of it evokes a goosebump reaction similar to that which you get in horror movies. As we lay in our tents, one of my friends told us all to shut up and listen to something he heard coming from one end of the canyon. He said that it sounded like a R whistle. Sure enough, there was some shrill noise faintly coming from where we had just trekked. We kind of wonder what the noise could be, and we thought maybe someone needed help. Maybe they broke an ankle or were cornered by an animal. I jokingly threw out the possibility that maybe it was the ghosts of the Native Americans angry at us for disturbing some sacred ground of theirs, and the sounds were of them tracking us through the canyon. Then a friend suggested maybe due to the shrill nature of the noise it was a banshee stalking us. As we were discussing the possibilities, I heard something coming from the other end of the canyon. I pointed it out to the other guys and as we fell silent I could immediately tell it wasn't an echo due to the noise being in a completely different register, yet still very shrill. However, it was still rather faint. But then a third noise popped up, and a fourth. And all the while the noises were getting louder, and louder, and louder, and louder. As it got louder, it became far more human-like, but extremely angry. We were all scared shitless at this point, completely seriously referring to these noises as banshees. These sounds got so loud that eventually we couldn't hear ourselves talk, and the sound penetrated through our skulls into our thoughts. An endless barrage of extremely high-pitched screaming, yet with it all seemingly completely in harmony and slowly undulating, like the breath of the ocean. It took up all sensation and all feeling. The moonlit night flooded this canyon with light, revealing the patterns created by dark streaks on the sandstone walls. After a while the fear subsided, and the noise, with its extremely pervasive quality, along with the scenery, completely freed me from my mind's stream of conscious thought that was the source of all worry. It was hauntingly beautiful the way I remember it, and this otherworldly sound we experienced in nature is what brings back the chills every time I think of it. As weird as it sounds, I am so thankful to have had experienced them. I will remember them as long as I live. If anyone is able to find sources of this sound, I will be forever grateful. My friend recorded it but lost his phone a couple months after the trip, and everyone I have asked since can't identify what may have caused this sound. I want to hear them again and relive that experience. I'm from Texas and my family has land on the Guadalupe River. I've been tormented by something out there for about 35 years and only recently came to realize that it's probably a Sasquatch family. Now that I know what they are, I'm more annoyed than anything but still don't feel safe there at night and especially outside. I saw a child and an adult in about 1989 when I was sleeping outside on a trampoline. The child, about 4.5 feet tall, its shoulders just barely breached the top of the trampoline frame, woke me up by accident and I scared it, I guess, because I was so startled. I sat straight up from sleeping. I'm guessing it tried to touch me because that's just about the only thing that I can think of that would have caused me to jolt awake like that. It grunted. Then I saw something very tall and lanky run in the opposite direction to the trees. I then heard a loud humming noise that seemed to come from all directions and passed out. I have had multiple interactions over the years, mostly hearing them and seeing the red eyes, and hearing them scream. I believe it lives under a bridge on X during the day where I and others have seen it on a dare to walk through the dark tunnel when we were kids. We heard something moving and it turned to look at us and we saw the red eyes. It was screaming, absolutely terrifying. It was about 7 or 8 feet tall. We didn't see a silhouette, only its eyes. At night it roams up and down the property line back and forth to the river. Recently we've found odd things to mark trails like X's and branches stuck in fences, tricycles tied 5 feet high in a tree with vines, sheets tied around tree branches, and a dead animal in a tree next to a fort. The fort could be from kids or poachers because it's next to a park, but I don't know. The fort and the animal in the tree area are where the sound came from the first time I heard it. To this day we are still hearing heavy deep breathing in the tree line, hearing strange bird noises in the middle of the night all around the house. And a few years ago I heard loud screaming on the river by the fort area. It sounded like a woman being hurt. I thought it was a mountain lion, so I just went inside. It was terrifying. I had been working as a park ranger at Little Buffalo State Park in central Pennsylvania for about 6 months when I had my encounter. It was August of 2006. My partner and I were driving around the park at night to do a final check of the area for the evening. We were about halfway through our section of the park when we got a call from dispatch saying that there was a camper who wanted us to come out and take a look at his RV because he thought it had been vandalized or broken into. I told dispatch that we would be there shortly. We turned our vehicle around and we arrived at this campsite within 5 minutes or so. We found a gentleman in his mid-60s standing outside his RV and looking very nervous. He walked up to our truck and I asked him if we could please take a look at his camper. His behavior was very unusual and so he cautiously agreed and walked over to the camper with us following closely behind. He was very nervous and he kept looking around the entire time, almost like he was expecting something to jump out. We took a quick look inside the camper and found nothing that appeared to be out of place or missing. I asked him if anything had been taken from inside and he said no, but that there were some things that he thought were moved around during the short time he was gone. I looked around for another minute or so before telling him that we didn't see anything wrong. We thanked him for calling us and then we started walking back towards the truck. That's when my partner, who is an avid hunter, said to me, "Do you smell that?" I stopped walking for a second because I honestly didn't notice any kind of odor other than the normal smell of a state park campground, mildew, pine needles, etc. My partner has spent many hours in the woods, so he knows his smells. He told me that it smelled like something was trying to cover up its own scent, and now that he said that, that's when I noticed it too. It was a very light odor, but definitely there. We looked around for another minute or so before my partner said, "I think we need to get out of here." We got into our truck and drove off towards the main area of the park, which is about 1 mile away from where we were at the campsite. We navigated our way up a path, and as soon as we got onto the main road that travels through the park, we both saw it. It looked like a 7 to 8 foot tall creature walking along the road. I was driving, so I didn't get a good look at it, but my partner saw it walk out onto the road in front of us. It then quickly crossed to the other side where there was more vegetation and trees. He said that he could only see the backside as it walked across the road, but that it had very wide shoulders, almost too wide for its body. He also said that he thought he could see long black hair covering its arms and shoulders, but he wasn't sure because it was dark. We drove around looking for this thing for about an hour. We had no luck finding anything else unusual, so we eventually gave up and returned to the office. The next day I couldn't stop thinking about it, so I went back to the site by myself in hopes of finding any evidence of what we saw or smelled there. But we found nothing out of place or unusual in any way. I decided to just move on and not focus on it since no concrete evidence could be found. I've heard of other encounters in this area as well, which makes me believe that there is something going on out here for sure. Also, there have been sightings reported from this area all the way over to Harrisburg. Anyway, that's my story. I'm not here to convince anybody that what I saw was real, but I know that what I saw and smelled was real. Also, there have been several reports of dead deer in the area, deer that are torn apart but not eaten. Now that's very unusual, to say the least, so I'm wondering if this is all connected somehow. The most common theory among hunters around here is that something is killing deer just for sport and then covering up its tracks or scent with another odor to mask its own. I can't quite figure out how that would work, but that's what some people are saying. In the end, I'm not sure exactly what I think is going on. A military man, Jay, went outside to have a smoke. He lives in the hills surrounding Deadwood, South Dakota. He spotted two kids walking up a hill. They stopped and looked at Jay, which spooked him. They were wearing dark hoodies and looked very strange. They turned and started to walk in Jay's direction. As they approached, Jay could plainly see that their eyes were completely black. They started to cross the street walking directly towards Jay, who introduced himself to them. They continued to advance toward him without saying a word. Frightened, he retreated into the house. Inside, he asked his wife if she heard him talking to the kids. She never heard anything. They soon went to bed. Jay then noticed one of the boys outside his window. He rushed to bolt the front door, as one of them was there too. He never made it to the door. For whatever reason, he turned around and went back to the bedroom, where he saw the boy standing outside his window. He went to grab his pistol. He wanted to scare them off. He assumed they were wearing masks. One was at the window and another was at the door. He was extremely scared now. The next thing he remembered was waking up in bed. His wife informed him that he had been gone for an hour and a half. "I did hear the door open and close. You weren't there," she told him. Jay had left the house at 4 a.m. and didn't return home until around 5:30 a.m. He rose out of bed and looked at his slippers on the floor beside him. The slippers were wet and a bit muddy. There were wet spots on the hallway and bedroom floor as well. He didn't remember anything other than seeing the black-eyed kid at the window, then waking in his bed later. Was Jay abducted by these black-eyed kids? What did they want? I don't like to talk about this incident or even have any thoughts about it because I really feel like whatever I saw could still possibly be watching me. or following me in some way, but I feel like in this community I could get some answers. On July 7th of last year, my boyfriend and I decided to go to a lake called Boiling Springs located in central Pennsylvania to do a late night photo shoot because he wanted to do something special for me on my birthday. We got to the lake around 11:30 p.m. and surprisingly when we got there we both were calm, happy and ready to take some pictures. I felt zero negative feelings or any type of negative presence in the air. We took some at the pool house and then we eventually made it to the lake area. We decided to lay down a blanket by a very old sycamore tree and watch the stars. Still, no feeling of negative presence and my body was on zero alert of having to fight or flight. To the left of us and more so behind us there was a gathering of brush and trees where it was completely dark and you couldn't see in. We were casually laughing and talking until all of a sudden we heard what we thought were dogs, then coyotes, and then they started to whimper as if they were being attacked or in pain. I said, "What is that?" I then started to be more alert. "Probably just a neighbor's dog," he said. Probably about 5 minutes after the whimpering stopped, I heard something heavy being dragged through the brush towards us. I got up on my knees with my heart beating out of my chest. I said, "Get up." My boyfriend just kept sitting there still not very fazed. About 10 seconds later I looked through the brush more and about only 8 feet away from me knelt a glowing white, bone-thin being on all fours digging in the dirt below it. Now, I don't have the best vision so about 3 different theories went through my head at once. Deer? Wolf? Person? Then my stomach dropped and tears welled in my eyes and my gut told me that whatever it was not any of these. My body and mind told me that this was not something that I've seen before or have ever encountered or even of this earth or dimension. I don't even remember getting up from the blanket, but my body jolted up and I started crying. What is that? I have never felt that level of fear. And the weirdest part? No response. Just kept digging and digging with its white front limbs. I wanted to scream but nothing came out. I thought I was going to pass out. I ran over behind the sycamore tree close to us, yet my boyfriend stayed sitting on the blanket, but I could tell he was terrified too. "What are you?" he yelled. When he said what and not who, I knew that what we were looking at was no human and not even an animal. It stopped digging, didn't look over at us, but talked in a language neither of us have ever heard. It sounded ancient, like no one had spoken that dialect for centuries. My boyfriend asked what? No response. He then asked, "Are you a trail hiker?" Slight pause, then it said in a deep bone-chilling voice, "Yes." Nothing after. He then nervously said, "Oh ha, are you traveling north or south?" "South." Still no more exchange of words until my boyfriend finally knew this wasn't right and stood up fast and said, "Well, sorry, my girlfriend and I were in your space. We're leaving now." At this point I had tears streaming down my face, my heart was vibrating my entire body and I could barely even move normally because of how much fear had taken over my body. Somehow we still managed to gather our things and run back to our car. We didn't say a word to each other until we got to the car. I honestly don't even remember the drive home, but I do remember I couldn't stop laughing from disbelief. It was almost like I disassociated on the ride home. The next day was my birthday and I was home alone in the morning. It was a sunny day, no clouds in the sky, but still I was alone and I felt like I was being watched. I went out and did errands before my birthday celebration and went to my salon just to be in public and around people. An old coworker of mine was someone I confided in about it and she actually grew up in Boiling Springs, Pennsylvania. She told me that she remembers there were random reports of cattle being multilated and even UFO sightings as well. She told me to never go back there at night. "Check the pictures you took that night." I've been told many times. I've checked and checked and there's nothing odd about any of them and no sighting of the creature. This was a life-changing event for me. It's something that will never leave my mind. The core feeling I felt when I saw it digging in the ground just a few feet away from me, I'll never forget. I think the most sickening aspect about this whole situation is that it was the eve of my birthday. That's just too personal and too ironic since we used to go there for months before that incident at night. Please everyone comment your thoughts. I would love to hear feedback from people who have had encounters as well. Other incidents have happened since then, nothing that raw or unsettling but more evidence that I have been marked. Everyone be safe and thank you for giving your time to read about my encounter. So two of my friends snuck out last summer and took a walk listening to music. Decided to sit down on the road and talked a bit, and they both heard a distant scream that sounded pretty similar to an elk screech but for like 1 second in duration. So they turned off the music and saw a huge humanoid horse looking thing sprint out of this forest into a field. And they said it was running really fast, like 40 miles per hour. They said it was kind of hunched and had a limp. Was lean but muscular, and was completely pale or gray and naked. They both sprinted home and FaceTimed each other. When they got home and told me and a few others about it the next day. I was in disbelief, so I snuck out on my bike the next night with my other friend and met up with the two original people along with some others and went looking for it. We heard the noises they described, and me and my one friend saw a pale Bigfoot looking creature walk in front of someone's barn. Light like 300 yards away, but we're not sure. We continued to do this for a few nights, and one of them was walking to meet up with us alone to go looking for it and had seen it like 5 times on the walk there. Sometimes like 20 feet in front of him. We probably all went looking for it like 6 or 7 times in total. The last time we went looking, we all saw it and it was super tall, like 8 to 10 feet. Super fast, and had these glowing eyes you could see from a mile away. I'm pretty sure I also saw it have these long greasy locks or strands of hair about shoulder length. Looked like a mix between a crawler, Eren Jaeger Titan form, and Jeff the Killer. It was creepy. And when it was on pavement, you could hear clopping noises like it had hooves or something. Aside from this, I was on a late night gas station walk later that summer with two of my friends at 3 in the morning. And on our way back, we saw something run or hobble across the road about 70 yards in front of us, and it looked pretty similar. However, it was much smaller, maybe 5 feet tall, but I could see it being maybe 7 feet if it was standing fully upright. Does anybody have an idea of what this massive thing could be? This was in rural Northeast Ohio. Edit, was reading this over and forgot to add. We were walking on the way back to my friend's house one of the nights, and behind somebody's house we heard the noise of a baby crying in the woods. Couldn't have been mistaken for anything else but a baby. My name is Tanya, and I am a teacher at a local school. One evening, after visiting a fellow teacher and friend, I began my journey home. To reach the bus stop, I had to traverse a forest track. Little did I know that this ordinary walk would soon become an extraordinary experience. As I made my way through the peaceful woods, a faint voice reached my ears. I halted, my curiosity piqued, scanning my surroundings for the source of the call. And there, just a few steps away, stood a small humanoid figure. It was unlike anything I had ever encountered before. The creature wore a tight-fitting black overall, resembling a diver's suit. To my astonishment, it communicated with me telepathically. The being introduced itself as a traveler, akin to the astronauts or cosmonauts of our own world, having journeyed from a distant corner of space. It sought my advice or, perhaps, my assistance. Despite the strangeness of the situation, I felt an overwhelming sense of calm and curiosity instead of fear. Compelled by intrigue, I agreed to accompany the enigmatic visitor to its spacecraft. Together, we veered off the beaten path, venturing deeper into the dense pine forest. And then, before me, loomed a colossal silver object resembling a flattened egg, towering like a medium-sized truck. It lacked wings or windows, its form defying conventional understanding. With a simple hand gesture from the alien, an invisible hatch materialized, revealing an entrance into the craft. Stepping inside, I found myself in a cabin devoid of visible controls or mechanical instruments. The creature motioned for me to settle into a deep armchair, which felt strangely inflatable and unnatural. As I sat, I scrutinized the alien more closely, noticing the details that had escaped me earlier. Its hands possessed six fingers, a peculiar trait. Its expressionless face seemed almost doll-like, and its mouth moved out of sync with its speech, reminiscent of a puppet. The alien explained that the interaction between us held immense significance for both scientific understanding and the advancement of civilization, both on Earth and its own planet. Astonishingly, it proposed a most extraordinary proposition, to engage in intimacy with the purpose of conception. It assured me of its unwavering commitment to care for me and our future child, offering assistance during critical times through imperceptible means. Months later, my child was born, evoking concerns among doctors due to his unique physical attributes. Yet, these worries soon dissipated as he thrived and grew, appearing outwardly ordinary except for a few peculiarities. His eyes lacked lacrimal glands, and his breathing became shallow during sleep. To ensure his well-being, I even secured a job at a nearby kindergarten to keep a watchful eye on him. In 1992, a local newspaper correspondent had the opportunity to meet the boy and hear his story. According to the journalist's account, when sunlight graced his eyes, they emitted a red glow akin to a Siamese cat, with his pupils transforming into vertical slits. Remarkably, the boy possessed a mature countenance resembling that of a Lilliputian. During their extensive conversation lasting 4 hours, the boy revealed that, besides myself, the journalist was the first person he had confided in regarding his extraordinary origins. He spoke with confidence, saying, "I am unafraid of our secret because my father will protect me from harm. I carry his knowledge and experience, inherited even before my birth. In some aspects, I embody his individuality, not just in flesh and blood." The boy, however, declined to demonstrate his abilities but hinted at changes within his own body, including temporary transparency. He expressed a desire to share his wisdom with those willing to help humanity, including the people of Russia, to navigate through challenging times. According to him, humanity stood on the precipice of an evolutionary leap, faced with the choice to embrace transformation or fade from the cosmos. He emphasized ecological concerns, the struggle to adapt to new technologies, and overpopulation. Moreover, the boy proclaimed that all religions were essentially one and urged the inhabitants of Earth to renew their consciousness, akin to ancient mystics and prophets, becoming spiritually awakened individuals living in harmony with the divine laws. In the second phase of his experiment, he aspired to determine if the qualities of Earth's inhabitants could be inherited, much like his father's qualities. With positive changes occurring on Earth, the boy believed his father's planet and its civilization could eventually join forces with ours. The story of this extraordinary encounter continues to intrigue and challenge the bounds of our understanding. It serves as a reminder that the universe holds wonders beyond our comprehension, offering glimpses into a realm where the extraordinary and the ordinary coexist in fascinating harmony. I did my undergrad at this tiny little college in the middle of a mountain range. Literally miles and miles of woods on every side. I think about 100 acres was technically the school's property, but except for the weird high security facility a few miles to the east, none of the neighbors cared if kids went hiking onto their property as long as they weren't destructive, and wore bright colors during hunting season. Had a kid the year above me get a calf full of birdshot after running into their property with a turkey call. Anyways. The point is, there is or was a lot of woods, and a lot of trail markers. My, now ex, still very violent or nutty, fiancé was in a grad program in the city, so we were living apart. I was planning on going on a quick 2-mile walk through the woods on a well-marked trail, just to see the lake, de-stress from midterms, etc. Relationship was extremely rocky at this point, and I get a phone call right before I start the trail. What it was about doesn't matter, the important part was that it was essentially a napalm bomb to the heart and my trust in humanity. Not trying to be dramatic, I was just a sensitive kid. So I took off sprinting down the trailhead, tears running down my face. Figured I'd take a slightly different trail that goes up a steep incline and maybe just burn myself out. It works, kind of. I'm catching my breath and still sobbing, and I hear a group of people on the trail headed towards me. Not wanting to be known as the crying girl in the woods and not entirely in my right mind, I took off running in a random direction, passing a lot of the tree houses and forts that people make in the woods, telling myself I know where I am and that I hike these woods often and can find my way back to either the trail entrance or to the road. I jumped two creeks, which in hindsight, should have stopped me, because that meant I was straying way off campus. But I kept going, slipping on branches and then picking a new direction to run in. I was a dumb kid. I was a really dumb kid. There were a couple turkey vultures following me, which wasn't too surprising. Kids left food out pretty often, so they tended to be watchful. On long hikes by myself, I'd often sing to them when they tagged along. I started getting tired and slowed down to a walk, heading towards a small clearing with some toppled birch trees to sit on. My face was all messed up and my hair had little sticks and leaves in it, but I wasn't crying anymore. I lit a cigarette and stared at the ground and felt pretty damn sorry for myself. At some point I stopped feeling pretty damn sorry for myself and started feeling jumpy, kind of tingly, and everything I saw had this new level of sharpness and clarity to it. It wasn't really a feeling that I was being watched, more like I was somewhere I really, really didn't belong. It was starting to get dark, I had no cell service, the only thing I had on me besides my phone was a lighter, pack of cigarettes, and small pocket knife. Shorts, t-shirt, light windbreaker. I was literally search and rescue's worst nightmare. Trying to calm myself down, I tried to find any trail markers. None. Didn't recognize anything around me, couldn't hear any running water, and was too turned around to know where the road was. It was getting pretty chilly, and the woods were starting to make that sound that I can only describe as teeming. I didn't want to wander in a random direction, but the feeling of dread kept getting stronger and stronger, so I slowing started walking. Started hearing things, mostly whispers, which I figured I was hallucinating due to dehydration or exhaustion. And then, the shadows. It was the strangest thing, these tall thin shadows being cast on the trees. I would have chalked it up to the sunset, but the movement of them was unnatural, and I kept catching them in the corner of my eye. They kind of swayed? Or kind of jumped? It was a strange juxtaposition between how thoroughly creeped out I was and how pretty the sunset was that night. I remember looking at the sky, trying to calm myself down and pick a direction that felt right. But no direction felt right. I kept getting turned around, heard a few distinctive twig snaps in the distance. A wicked chill ran down my spine, and at this point I wasn't thinking eldritch forest elves, I was thinking bobcat or black bear. Started sniffling and crying silently again because I knew I had messed up. I was 50 shades of paranoid, dehydrated, and I pray to God hallucinating. And then I heard a rustle of wings that just about scared the shit out of me, and I looked up and there was the vulture. Just looking at me. I was so out of it that I think I asked it for help. It stared at me for a few more seconds and then took off. It landed on a branch a few meters away and stared at me, doing the angry feather fluff thing that they do. Walked up to the tree it was perched in, and it took off again and landed on another branch a ways away. So I did what any sane person would do in that situation and follow the vulture. The feeling of dread slowly wore away and I started feeling okay. It was such a polite vulture, waiting for me to catch up and then flying off again. I don't remember how long I followed it, just that it was a while, and even when it was getting really twilight dusky out I still felt safe. I started recognizing landmarks, glacial boulders, the tree forts, and could hear voices up ahead. The vulture led me a few more meters, right onto the main trail, and then stayed put. I thanked it, apologized, and made my way towards the group of people camped out. I knew a bunch of the kids, they freaked out. I was promptly handed hot tea and French fries. They asked how the hell I made my way out there, and I just shrugged. I didn't feel like sharing about the vulture, and when I tried to spot him again, he'd flown off. Here's the real scary part of the story though. No one realized I was gone. I lived alone, and my friends had assumed that I wasn't answering texts because I was studying. It was also a Friday, meaning that no one would have even thought it strange I was gone, as I often left to the city without telling anyone for the weekend. Essentially, no one would have even started looking until Monday, at which point I might have been either bobcat food or a sacrifice to the dear god. So thank you, my kind, kind vulture friend. Vultures are hands down my favorite animals now. I recently received a telephone call from a friend of an eyewitness who was born and raised in a northwest suburb of Chicago, Illinois. The only specific location reference was given as near the Des Plaines River. The eyewitness D discussed multiple sightings from 1978 through 1988 while he lived there as a boy. The sightings would usually occur at dusk and would continue throughout the night, and there were at least two winged creatures always seen flying in a wide circle at an altitude of 500 to 600 feet. The creatures were silhouetted against the clouds that were backlit by the city lights. The description of these creatures was that there was no head or neck that could be seen. They had long, thick tails, but no legs or feet were visible. The huge wings had no feathers but were membraned, similar to that of a dragon or pterosaur. Apparently, the neighborhood residents were well aware of the nightly sightings. When I was 18, my then boyfriend and I were outside and we heard footsteps, so we got scared and ran inside. When we finally worked up the nerve to go back out so he could leave, I reached for the doorknob and the doorknob started shaking and there was a simultaneous loud knocking on the door. We started screaming, of course, and went and woke up my father, who went outside with the gun, and nothing was there. My father has lived there for 60 years and isn't one that believes in paranormal anything. He makes comments about the noises and had someone tear down the crosses in the fence after I told him about what I had learned. He would never admit it, but I'm sure he's probably seen things too. Thanks for watching. Be sure to subscribe for daily stories. We at Horror Den of Misfits really enjoy this, and your support would be appreciated.